Dear doctors, we are live now.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We welcome you all from Delhi Orthopedic Association to the regular Sunday evening webinars. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. So a very warm welcome to all the delegates, a galaxy of faculty, and it's a very important day for us today. We are celebrating the Bone and Joint Week throughout the nation, and Delhi is taking special efforts on bringing out a very nice week-long agenda. So just a minute about Bone and Joint Week. This has been there since 2012. We started with a Bone and Joint Day. This was when the Indian Orthopedic Association was registered long back, and the week attached with 4th of August is celebrated as Bone and Joint Week. This week is celebrated by a lot of awareness programs, a lot of educational programs, a lot of beyond orthopedic programs. So we are going to have a lot of events these 7 days. And for over a decade now, the musculoskeletal imaging CME is one of the very, very important CMEs that Delhi Orthopedic conducts. The orthopedic surgeons are looking forward to it because there are always advances in imaging and people want to update their knowledge. This being important part of orthopedics and not covered very extensively in the curricula, even the PG and the residents are very hooked up to this program. So we are grateful to our colleagues as well as the radiology colleagues who have joined in today and would be sharing in knowledge, which should be very useful to one and all. Now, we always invite a lot of questions in such CMEs. There is a chat box available with all of you, and you can just type your questions there, and the moderator will take up the questions with the faculty, and we hope to answer as many queries as we can, the delegates have. So with not any other delay, I would hand it over to the moderator for today's session, which is Dr. Pradeep Bagheja. He is the Vice President of Delhi Orthopedic Association, a senior consultant, orthopedic surgeon and knee surgeon at Sir Gangaram Hospital. And he is also the joint secretary of Indian Orthopedic Association. So Dr. Bagheja would introduce the faculty and then take the webinar ahead. Over to Dr. Bagheja.
Thank you so much, Dr. Lalit Mani, sir. And without wasting too much time, I will just give a brief introduction to all the faculties who have taken out time from the busy schedule that one Sunday. So today is the 1st August, and as Dr. Mani explained very well, this week is the Bone and Joint Week, and we started from today. And Dr. Mani is maintaining this position for last 1 year and is very active president. And we all are working under him, and he wants us to work hard to deliver some message for this year for all the level of orthopedics. And Dr. Hitesh Lal is with us as a secretary. And the first session is a shoulder, where we are covering two topics, rotator cuff injuries and shoulder instabilities. And the speakers for this shoulder sessions are Dr. Shekhar Srivastava, who is a very good friend of mine, and right now, he's a head of department in Sant Permanent Hospital. He has done AO fellowships and fellowships in arthroscopic and sports medicine and working as a knee and shoulder specialist. Welcome, Dr. Shekhar.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr.
And the next speaker is Dr. Shriram, who is always with us in MSK meeting because he's very active radiologist and is always a phone call away whenever we need his help. And Dr. Shriram right now is a presently head of department in Mahajan Imaging in Defense Colony. He has got 19 years experience in MSK imaging, special interest in MSK MR, MSK ultrasound, and advanced neuro applications. He has done short fellowships in cardiac imaging from Munich, musculoskeletal imaging from San Diego, published articles in national and international journals, chapters. He has got chapters in API, textbook of medicine, 8th edition on MRI, and numerous national conference lectures. And he presented papers in, I think, all our radiology conferences, ESGAR 2009, RS NA 18, EESR, ECR 2019, Vienna, and RS NA 2019. Welcome, Dr. Sriram. I hope we'll get some good message from you after every talk for the shoulder imaging. So next session will be the spine, which will be covered by two senior faculties, Dr. Bakshi from Gangaram Hospital and Dr. Gururaj from Indian Spine Injury Center. The topics will be covered in lumbar PIVD and lumbar canal stenosis, followed by spondylolisthesis. Dr. Bakshi is in Gangaram for last so many years, 30 years I'm seeing him there. And sir is director, professor, Gripmer, Gangaram, and he's a head of department in CT and MRI, adjunct professor in imaging science in the School of Medicine and Dentistry, University of Rochester, advisor to State Government of Delhi Health Services, chairman, Educational Trust Imaging Today, honorary consultant advisor, Armed Forces Medical Services, ex-president, Delhi IRIA, and he has delivered more than 300 guest lectures on CT and MRI, India and abroad. Sir has got over 60 publications, national and international, two book chapters, and special interest in neuroradiology, musculoskeleton, GI, liver, and biliary disease. Welcome, sir. Good to see you on Sunday evening. Next is, he's a young orthopedic spine surgeon from Indian Spine Center, Dr. Gururaj. He has done MBBS and MS from St. John, Bangalore. He did FNB spine surgery from Indian Spine Center, Delhi. And right now he's working as a senior consultant and unit head, Department of Spine Surgery, Indian Spine Center, New Delhi. And he's a visiting fellow in Minimal Assessed Spine Surgery, Munich, Germany, Spinal Deformity, USA, Hong Kong, Cervical Spine Surgery from Japan, and Spinal Tumor Surgery from Italy. Welcome, Dr. Gururaj, and accepting my invitation for today's talk. The next session will be on the DEXA scan, which I've just kept it because we are using DEXA scan very often now in the osteoporosis treatment. And I requested my head in Gangaram Hospital, Dr. Ritu Verma. She is working as a head department of nuclear medicine in Maji Imaging Center, Gangaram Hospital. And her area of interest are nuclear neuroimaging. She has got research publication approximately 50, out of which 10 in the field of nuclear neuroimaging. Guide, co-guide of 16 DNB theses in the departments of nuclear medicine, neurology, nephrology, and pediatrics. She has got presentation, platform, and poster at RSNA Chicago 2018, ECR Vienna 2019, International Conference of Alzheimer's Disease and Parkinson's Disease, AD/PD, Portugal 2019, World Congress of Neurology, UAE 2019, RSNA Chicago 2019. Welcome, madam. We'll be happy to hear from you. The last topic, which is knee, I kept in the last because this is our main zone of working of 80% orthopedic surgeons. We are covering two areas, mainly all about meniscus injuries, which will be covered by Dr. Mittal, which includes tears, root, ramp lesions, and all about ligament injuries, ACL, PCL, MCL, and LCL, which will be covered by Dr. Praveen Gulati, sir. Dr. Ravi Mittal, sir, is AIIMS. He's a professor of orthopedics in All India Institute of Medical Science. And sir has got a lot of faculties, all national, international, area, mainly arthroscopy, shoulder and knee, he's working, and almost 70 to 80 publications. Welcome, Dr. Mittal, sir.
Thank you.
We have Dr. Gulati with us, Dr. Praveen Gulati. Sir is graduate and postgraduate from Maulana Azad Medical College, Director Chief Radiologist in Dr. Gulati Imaging Institute, Department of Radiology, he's heading NHI, National Heart Institute, Accreditation Committee Member of NABH for Imaging Services, Joint Editor, IJRI, Member Ethics Committee, JNU. He has authored chapter in 16 books, more than 80 publications, recipient of number of honors and awards. Welcome, Dr. Gulati, sir, and we'll be happy to hear from you. This humble request to all the faculties, kindly keep the talks from 10 minutes and 5 minutes for discussion. And I hope after this evening meeting, we are going to have good learning from all the experts. So I stop the sharing and I give to the Dr. Shekhar to start with for his first session on shoulder. Dr. Shekhar, please.
Thank you, Dr. Bageja. So, first of all, I thank the Delhi Orthopedic Association, the president of Delhi Orthopedic Association, Dr. Lalit Maini, Dr. Bageja, Secretary Dr. Hitesh Lal, for inviting me for this talk. Now, this has become a very regular event, and it is quite popular among the students as well as working as well as the practicing orthopedic surgeons. Now, we'll be starting with shoulder imaging, and I'll be speaking more on imaging of shoulder instability. Now, we all know that the shoulder diagnosis of shoulder instability is basically clinical. Most of the time, the patient comes with the diagnosis, and he will either have a dislocation. Or in sports person, sometimes they come with the subtle instability, like they are not able to give their full performance, or they feel weakness in their arm. Sometimes they feel a click, and you do proper examination and you come to a diagnosis of instability. Okay, so the diagnosis is mainly clinical. Now the imaging techniques, it helps in confirming our diagnosis, and it also helps in formulating our treatment plan. Now, all these three imaging modalities are important for diagnosing or for management of shoulder instability. This includes plain X-rays, the MRI, and the CT scan. Now, most of the time, what we see that in shoulder, we get just one view, the AP view. We understand that in all other parts of the body, we go for two views, AP and lateral. But in shoulder, most of the time, you take only one view. But I just want to emphasize that here in shoulder also, it's very important that you take two views. Apart from AP, you should take either bilateral or this West Point view. Now, the importance of this view is that it helps in giving you an idea about any bony erosion on the glenoid side, especially in chronic cases, patients who are having chronic instability. They can get either erosion of the glenoid or there can be bony avulsion. So those are seen quite well on this view. Now, here you can see that the patient comes with a dislocation shoulder. It's quite clear on AP. But if you do a bilateral, you can clearly see that it has gone anteriorly. So you should have two views. Now, after reduction, if you see the X-ray very closely, then you can see that there is something wrong here. You can see the sclerotic margin of the glenoid here, but something is missing here. And if you see that, there's a fragment lying here. So X-rays can also give you an idea about bony avulsions. Now it's very important to diagnose bony avulsions because these are the cases where you would like to go in, where you would like to operate even after first dislocation. So these are the situations where first-time dislocators also need surgery. Now, if you watch X-rays closely, then you can pick up these cases in some cases. Or if you have any doubt, then you can go for further investigations like CT scan. Similarly, for posterior dislocation, this is the classic picture of light bulb sign. So whenever the humeral head is not facing towards the glenoid, that means that should ring a bell in your mind that something is wrong. And you go for the other view and you can see that the head is lying posteriorly. So your take-home message one is that X-ray are must in every shoulder instability. It's not that you just send the patient for MRI. You must do proper X-rays. Two views are a must. And you must look for bony bank cut. Just look the X-ray carefully. And if there's a bony bank cut, you may get some hint, and then you should go for further investigations. Because what happens most of the time, we treat these patients conservatively. Unless it's a chronic case, 3 to 4 dislocations, most of us manage these patients conservatively. But if there's a bony Bankart lesion, it has to be treated immediately. So you must closely look for bony Bankart lesions, and X-rays can give you some idea about that. Then comes the most important diagnostic tool for shoulder instability, that is the MRI. So these are the three cuts which are usually taken: the coronal oblique, sciatal oblique, and the axial cuts. Now let's see what's the pathology seen in what happens in shoulder dislocation or shoulder instability. Now in most of the cases, shoulder comes out anteroinferiorly. So as it is dislocating anteroinferiorly, there is avulsion of this capsulolabral structure. Okay, and here you get the typical Bankart lesion. So that's very typical lesion seen in shoulder instability, the anteroinferior shoulder instability. This labrum is most important for stability of the shoulder joint because it deepens the glenoid fossa, it provides attachment of the capsule and the glenohumeral ligament and the biceps tendon. So abnormality in the labrocapsular structure is the commonest pathology seen in shoulder instability, and that's what we are trying to see in MRI. Okay, that too, this abnormality in the inferior part of the glenoid, not in the superior part. So when you are seeing the axial cuts, you must focus on the cuts which are below the level of coracoid. So avulsion of the labrocapsular complex and Hill-Sachs lesion. So what happens? The shoulder dislocates anteriorly, anteroinferiorly, and then the posterior superior part of the head, it banks against the anteroinferior margin of the glenoid, producing this Hill-Sachs lesion. And you can have this bony avulsion. So you can have pure labrocapsular avulsion, or there can be a piece of bone which gets avulsed along with the labrum. So these are the main lesions which you see in an acute dislocation. So the soft tissue lesions which are seen are on the glenoid side, you can have Bankart or Bankart variant. And on the humeral side, you see HAGL. So we'll see what is that. And if you talk about bony lesions, then on the glenoid side, you will see bony Bankart, or in chronic cases, you get attrition of the glenoid. And on the humeral side, you see the Hill-Sachs lesion. So when you are looking at the MRI, you must find out the location of the lesion, whether it is anteroinferior, posteroinferior, or is it superior slap lesion. So you must see the location of the lesion. Extent of the lesion. What is the extent of the lesion? Is it just anteroinferior, or is it going posteriorly also? Sometimes it can be panlabral lesion. Whether the periosteum is ruptured along with the labrum or not, then it becomes, if the periosteum is ruptured along with a labrum, then it is a classic Bankart lesion. If the periosteum is intact, then it is a Bankart variant. So this is the normal labrum, the axial cut. This is anterior, this is posterior. And you can see that the labrum is attached to the glenoid. Now here you can see that the labrum is detached from the glenoid. So this is a Bankart lesion. Again, a Bankart lesion, the labrum is detached from the glenoid, and there is a Hill-Sachs lesion posteriorly. So very typical of instability. In this picture, you see that the labrum is detached, but the periosteum is still intact. So that is a Bankart variant, okay? Now, as a clinician, our treatment doesn't change as much. If the patient is having instability, whether it's a Bankart lesion or a Bankart variant, you are going and doing the repair. Same thing you can see on the posterior instability. So here you can see that there is avulsion of the posterior labrum. And sometimes it can also get avulsed along with the bone. So you can get a posterior Bankart lesion along with the bone, posterior bony Bankart. So the capsule along with labrum can get detached from here, leading to Bankart lesion. But sometimes what happens, this capsule is also attached to the neck of the humerus, and it can get avulsed from this part. So that is known as humeral avulsion of glenohumeral ligament. Okay. So these glenohumeral ligaments, which are attached on the glenoid side, are also attached on the humeral side. So when it gets detached from the humeral side, that is known as Hagel lesion. So normally, you see this axillary pouch the capsule is coming from the neck of the glenoid and is attached to the neck of the humerus. When it gets detached from here, then this U shape is gone. Okay, and you can see the capsule here. Okay, so that is your Hagel lesion. The bony lesions on the humeral side can appear either as just edema in acute case, or in chronic cases, you get a good defect of the bone. Now, the size of the defect and the extent of the defect in the Hill-Sachs lesions are very important, but they can be assessed more accurately on CT scan. So we'll discuss that on CT scan. And there can be bony lesions also on the glenoid side, but once you're suspecting any bony lesion on the glenoid side, then it's very important to do CT scan. So on MRI, MRI is most sensitive and helpful tool to diagnose the labral lesion. Axial cuts are most important. It's very important to assess the location and the extent of the lesion because your treatment plan will be according to that. It also helps in addressing, it also helps in diagnosing any concomitant lesions, like there can be a slab lesion along with your Bankart lesion. Or in elderly, there can also be a cuff tear along with Bankart lesion. So that can be easily assessed on MRI. But if you suspect any bony defects, then perhaps MRI is not as sensitive as a CT scan. So the CT scan in shoulder instability, it is helpful to assess bony avulsions in acute cases. So if you have any doubt on X-ray that there is a bony avulsion, then perhaps CT scan will give you a better idea. In chronic cases, it is helpful to assess bony erosions, and then it helps in formulating the treatment plan based on on-track and off-track lesion. That we'll see how. So why does bone loss occur in instability? It can be either bony Bankart lesion, like we discussed before. There can be attritional glenoid bone loss. Okay, because of repeated instability, there can be attrition of the anteroinferior part of the glenoid. And there can be Hill-Sachs lesion. So why does bone loss matter? Because various studies have shown that the most important reason for failure of Bankart repair is bone loss, failure to address bone loss. So if the bone loss is more than a critical level, and if you still go ahead and just treat the patient by repairing the Bankart lesion, either arthroscopic or open, it's going to fail. So in that case, you have to address the bone loss. So that's why assessing or properly quantifying the bone loss is very important. Now, these are the CT scan images of a doctor from Bareilly, and he had this acute injury in the shoulder dislocation, and there was this hint of bony avulsion, the bony Bankart. So you can see, if you do a CT scan, it can just show this extent and the pattern of this bony avulsion very clearly. You can just take out the humeral head and you can have a full view of the glenoid. And here you can see that this is the part of the bone which is avulsed. And accordingly, you can plan your treatment. You want to do an arthroscopic repair or you want to do an open repair. If there is combination, then you can just do a Letarge. So all this thing you can assess very beautifully on CT scan. MRI can give you some hint, but it will not give you such a good pattern of injury. Now, in case of attritional bone loss, there are various tools available with our radiologist, which helps them to give an idea about the percentage of bone loss. So you compare it with the opposite side. Now, on the glenoid side, if your bone loss is more than 25%, that signifies that it is a very significant bone loss, and you need to do something for that. If you just do a soft tissue repair, it's probably going to fail. Similarly, on the humeral side, if the bone loss is more than 40% of the volume of the head, then it becomes significant. But nowadays, what's more important is not the depth or the volume of the defect, but the extent of the lesion. So if your Hill-Sachs lesion is extending more medially, then it becomes more significant, because then that lesion becomes off-track lesion. So here you can see that this is your GT and this is the extent of your Hill-Sachs lesion. But in this case, the Hill-Sachs lesion is extending quite medially. So this lesion is more significant than this lesion. The depth doesn't matter that much. It is the medial extent of the Hill-Sachs lesion which matters more. Now, we must understand that in any instability, the bony defects are not isolated. It's not that you will just have a glenoid bone defect or just have a Hill-Sachs bone defect. So there is a bipolar lesion, and you have to assess both the lesions in combination to see what has to be done. Like in this case, you see there is no glenoid bone defect and there's a Hill-Sachs defect. Now, this patient is also having similar Hill-Sachs defect, but there is also a glenoid bone defect. Now, here, because there is no glenoid bone defect, so the margin of the head is supported by the bone. And if you do a bank cut repair, this is going to hold and you will have a good result. But in this case, if you just do a bank cut repair, it is going to fail because the head is falling into this defect. There will be a lot of force or pressure on the repair and it is going to fail. So this lesion, we'll call it as an on-track lesion, and this is an off-track lesion. So there are formulas which will help you to combine the defect of the humeral side and the glenoid side to find out which lesions are on track and which lesions are off track. And accordingly, you can plan your treatment. Now, all these things can be done on CT scan. So CT scan is an absolute must where bony defect is suspected. It helps in assessment of glenoid and humeral defect and the interplay between them. So that is the glenoid tract defect. So we see that all these three modalities of imaging is very important for assessment and formulating a management plan for shoulder instability. Thank you. I end my talk giving tribute to this great person, my mentor, an excellent surgeon, and one of the finest gentlemen I have come across, Dr. Shekhar Agrawal. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shekhar. Thank you so much for a wonderful talk. Any question from the faculty, please? I want to ask one question to Dr. Shekhar.
Yes, please.
Like posterior dislocation, we always missed in the practices, operating practices, right? And we always discuss in the X-ray, like bulb sign. What is the added investigation to clear the doubt? Other than the clinical examination, what is the added investigation advice to go for it if you can't make out on the lateral view, which you're suggesting go for lateral view? In case you can't, what is the next investigation you advise to rule out posterior dislocation?
Dr. Pradeep, I think if we take two different views, then it becomes quite clear. Especially these patients have locked external rotation. Okay, their arm is locked in internal rotation. So first of all, clinically, you must suspect that this patient is having some problem. And in fact, whenever you are having some problem in the shoulder, you must make sure that you get two views. If you get proper two views, which is not very difficult to get, you can easily diagnose that. Other investigations, one can go for CT scan and all that, but if you can diagnose it on X-ray, then what's the need to go for CT scan? That's my only submission.
So if at all want to go for, we'll go for CT scan, am I right?
Yeah.
Clear the diagnosis, right? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Shekhar. I think there's no other question from the chat box. So we can go to next talk from Dr. Shiram, please.
Thank you. Thank you for the invitation for this lecture. The allotted 10 minutes, I hope to cover at least some things about MRI of the shoulder for the rotator cuffs. Typical sequences which we take are axial, sagittal, and coronal fat saturated proton density images, which are very good for evaluation of tendons, the labrum, cartilage, and definitely the tendon, the ligaments. The other one thing which we need to do is a sagittal T1 weighted image, which I'll show in the talk, which is required to evaluate for fatty infiltration and even on actually to evaluate glenoid fossa bone loss. So classical ways in which the coronal and sagittal images are taken depends on what is the pathology suspected. If we are trying to look for the glenoid fossa, that means we are trying to look for instability, then the images have to be parallel and perpendicular to the glenoid. Whereas if it is for the rotator cuff, typically it should be parallel and perpendicular to the supraspinatus. Most technicians try to do it in relation to the muscle, but the best thing which needs to be done is in relation to the tendon, which is how you will get a oblique coronal and oblique sagittal image, which will actually show what is going on. The typical checklist for the rotator for any MR shoulder is to evaluate the CA arch, the cuff, and the intra-articular pathology. I'll be covering in this just the rotator cuff. So the interesting questions are which plane to look for, which tendon. The supraspinatus is typically evaluated on the coronal plane. The axial plane is best for subscap and infraspinatus and sometimes for evaluation of the shape of these supraspinatus tendon tear. And sagittal is very good for evaluation of the AP dimensions of the tear. One of the concepts is that of rotator cable, which had been described by Burkhardt. That is a condensation of the coracohumeral ligament in the undersurface of the cuff. So like you can see on these images, there's this dark signal which is going from the subscapularis superior third all the way up till the superior half of the infraspinatus. On the coronal images, you tend to see this image over here. So if you have a cuff, which is a cable dominant cuff, which in which you'll see a large hypointensity on undersurface, the cable takes up stress during contraction and less easily tears, and tears can occur through the critical zone of the crescent. Even if the there is a full thickness supraspinatus tendon tear, if the infraspinatus and subscapularis are intact, the cable takes up the function and the patient might not have abduction loss. On the other hand, if it is a crescent dominant cuff, it will more easily tear, there will be a diffuse tear, and you will get a dead arm in clinical exam. Now, when you're looking at a MR of the shoulder, the first thing you need to look at is to orient yourself. So the anterior cuts are visualized by looking at the coracoid process. So when you see this finger-like extension over here, and you can see the conjoint tendon of short head of biceps and coracobrachialis, you know you're at the anterior-most cuts. When we're coming a little bit more posteriorly, you can start seeing the acromioclavicular joint, and you can see the biceps tendon passing in a 90-degree angle. This is the section beyond which the supraspinatus tends to be seen. So just behind this would be the anterior leading edge of the supraspinatus, and thereafter the anterior mid and posterior thirds of the supraspinatus. Once the AC joint finishes, then we come to typically the infraspinatus. So even though it looks like it's arching over there like a supra, this is actually an infraspinatus footprint lesion with a deepened bare area. And that's also a small articular surface partial tear of the critical zone. The other thing which we need to identify on the axial images is to see the way the infraspinatus tendon wraps around the supra on the axial images. This is a normal case on the image on the left. On the image on the right, you can see that there is a high-grade partial tear of the infraspinatus tendon. The supra itself looks normal. So to understand this concept, there are three facets of the greater tuberosity. The anterior or the horizontal facet predominantly is there for the supraspinatus. The mid and oblique is for the infraspinatus, and the posterior or vertical facet is for infraspinatus and teres minor. However, there is a significant extent of the infraspinatus into the horizontal facet. So what are the signs of a supraspinatus or rotator tendon tear? First is altered signal, a fluid-like signal, and altered morphology. So if you see a crinkling appearance coming over here, loss of a black line. So normally you tend to have a black line in the bursal, and on the articular surface, this is the black line you're talking about. If you see that there's loss of the line, that means we're talking about a tendon tear. That's what this graphic shows, that there's a tendon tear over here. The localization of the rotator cuff tear is very important. Width, we describe it as partial or full thickness, which means from the bursal to the articular surface, how much of the width is involved. It might be a full thickness tear, but only involving a part of the tendon, in which case this is not going to be a complete tear. Complete means anteroposteriorly, which is something like that. Now, when you have a full thickness tear, this is how it will look like. You'll see a full thickness tear with some amount of retraction. That would be a bursal surface partial tear. The articular surface is intact, and you can see some partial retraction of the bursal surface. And here again, you have the bursal surface intact, and the articular surface appears to be torn. There are some other concepts. One is known as PASTA or PAINT. PASTA is partial articular side supraspinatus tendon avulsion. So it's a delaminating tear of the articular side of the supraspinatus, and it occurs from the footprint. You can have a reverse PASTA, which will be a bursal surface such tear. PAINT, on the other hand, is a tear of the critical zone, which interstitial extension, and that is different from a PASTA lesion. The other thing which you can identify is the shape of the tear on axial and coronal sagittal images. Crescent-shaped tear tends to be smaller mediolaterally, larger anteroposteriorly, and whereas the U-shaped tear, it will be much more wider mediolaterally than anteroposteriorly. Again, on the axial images, you can see it over here. And here you can see that that's the width of retraction. Finally, you have an L-shaped tear, which occurs in very massive tears. So you have an anteroposterior component and you have one which dissects inside. This typically occurs in the case of an infraspinatus tendon tear. You see a full thickness tear over there and you can see it extending into the infraspinatus. So when we talk about full thickness tears, the important thing is retraction. The retraction, is it occurring short of the equator, which is the highest point of the humeral head? Is it coming towards the equator, or is it, if it's beyond the equator of humeral head like here, if it has gone beyond the glenoid, then typically it's more than 3 centimeters of retraction, which implies that the surgery would be a little bit more difficult. Once we have a full thickness tear or once we have a partial tear, we need to evaluate whether there is reduced bulk and fatty infiltration. So this typically shows a Y-shaped appearance of the coracoid and acromion, and you typically have a tangent of the supraspinatus which goes above the level of the tangent. If it goes below, then that means there is reduced bulk. Here you compare the fatty infiltration of the supraspinatus compared to the deltoid, and you have a Gotelier's grade classification, which I won't be going into right now. The other thing is the reflection pulley of the long head of biceps tendon. You have the rotator cable which goes down here, forms the coracohumeral ligament, and on the inferior surface, the superior glenohumeral ligament. This forms the pulley on which the biceps tendon tends to go for a 90-degree angle. In this case, you can have an isolated lesion of the biceps pulley in which the cuff itself is intact, the subscapular is intact, but here you can see that there is tear of the junction between the coracohumeral and superior glenohumeral ligament, which is shown on this graphic. Then you have various descriptions on the post-op cuff, like you have a Sugaya classification. That's low signal, normal thickness. Again, normal thickness, but bright signal. Here again, there is a partial discontinuity. And here you have a full thickness tear in maybe one odd section. And here, if it's more than 2 sections, which means it's a massive discontinuity. The other thing in a post-op cuff we need to talk about is whether the tendon failure has occurred at the footprint, which is a type 1, or at the myotendinous junction, which tends to occur quite frequently in infraspinatus tendons, a type 2 tendon pair failure. Last slide of my talk would be when to get an MR arthrogram for a rotator cuff. So if there is paucity of glenohumeral fluid and there is a strong clinical suspicion of an abnormality. Now here, if you see on the images, there is paucity of glenohumeral joint fluid. There appears to be some cartilage lesion over here. The cuff appears quite thin. So there might be a chronic tear. In this case, you can see that on the MR arthrogram, one is that there is condral denudation of the superior humeral head, which has occurred because of superior migration. And there is interstitial extension of the contrast into the cuff, which is well delineated. This is a delaminating kind of tear, and which is only seen on an MR arthrogram. And that's the last slide, and thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Sriram, for valid elaboration of the RCA injuries, rotator cuff injuries. Any question from the faculty, please?
Dr. Bagheja, can I ask a couple of questions?
Yeah, please, sir.
Dr. Sriram, as usual, excellent lecture. A couple of things I wanted to ask. One is, normally, as a general orthopedic surgeon, we just advise an MR of shoulder, whether it comes to instability or rotator cuff or some other pathology. And what I understand is mostly the patient will go to a center and the radiographer will do certain sequences and send the patient away. Is there some specific instructions you people give to the radiographer, which sequences to take, when to take, and does he go through the likely pathology or diagnosis of the orthopedic surgery?
Yeah. Yeah. So this question is a pretty good question. We've experimented with various imaging protocols. What we found is that we need an idiot-proof protocol. That means something which will work despite whatever the indication goes. So in almost all cases, we have four sequences, axial, coronal, and sagittal FSPD images and a sagittal T1 weighted image. We normally always do it in relation to the cuff. If the patient has instability, in that case, the technologist has been instructed to get the history and then do it in relation to the glenoid. There are rare instances when the patient has acromioclavicular pathology. In that case, the coronal tends to be done in a slightly different plane from the coracoid to the biceps tendon, biceps groove. That also has been given instructions that, you know, whenever you have a separate kind of pathology, something additionally needs to be done. Usually about 9 to 11 hours of the scan during our clinic hours, they are overseen by radiologists, typically by me. So in those such cases, I would be able to say if there's any special sequence which needs to be done.
Okay, thank you. Other things I want to know about the grading of this tier. You said the low grade tier or high grade partial tier. I mean, what does grading mean?
So when we are talking about low grade or high grade, we are talking about basically less than 50% width or more than 50% width. So if it's a low grade partial tear, then that would mean that it's less than 50%. We have a terminology which is in orthopedic literature of tendon fraying. Tendon fraying implies that there is just subtle irregularity, which you will just see it on your arthroscopy. It does not have as much of a functional significance. Low-grade partial tear would be something like, say, 30%, 40%. High-grade articular surface partial tear, for example, would be more than 50. Sometimes we mention a near full thickness, which means that there are just a few strands which are left over. So high-grade, low-grade in all tendon or ligament pathology is always less than or more than 50%.
So width means the depth of the tear.
Yeah. From bursal to articular surface, the width is that. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other question? Dr. Shriram, for shoulder imaging, the Tesla is very important, like 0.5 or 1.5 or 3 Tesla. Is it really very important or we can go in all same?
So, if you go for a 0.5 or a 0.3 Tesla scan, as long as the pathology is gross, you'll be able to pick it up quite well. But small pathologies will not be picked up. So if there is a small labral tear, a slab tear, if there is a delaminating tear in the cuff, all of those things are not going to be seen on lower field strength. 1.5 Tesla versus 3 Tesla, if the 1.5 Tesla scanner is being run by a radiologist who knows his physics and knows how to do it very well, which is extremely rare, in such a case, the 1.5 Tesla would be good. Otherwise, generally speaking, a 3 Tesla with a dedicated musculoskeletal radiologist is what is required. And that would really show you cartilage, it will show you labrum, it will show you rotator cuff, everything. In fact, this is just an additional comment. Dr. Shekhar Srivastava was mentioning that, for bony abnormalities, an MR is not good. I kind of agree and disagree on that, in the sense that in almost all cases in which we have multiple shoulder dislocations, we give a assessment of the glenoid fossa bone loss and the off-track and on-track on the MR. We are doing it only on one shoulder. We're not doing it a comparison with the opposite shoulder. The situation where a CT scores over MR is actually when you're talking about looking for union of the Bankart fragment. That is something which MR cannot show as well. The fragment, loose bodies, everything is seen fantastically on MR. So that's not something which is missed out. In fact, we can show a bony Bankart lesion, whether there's a Bankart variant, Perthes lesion, all of those things are very well seen on MR. But if it's a chronic Bankart and we are unsure whether there is a union which has occurred of the Bankart, that would be a bit of a challenge.
Shekhar, your comment.
No, what we are talking about is the standard thing. But of course, Shriram does wonderful things with MRI machine, and I am sure they can give very good results. But in general, if you talk about if you talk about the standard thing in all the centers, then perhaps CT scan is known to be more sensitive for assessing the bone part, and MRI is considered to be better for soft tissue lesions. But I'm aware that with a new protocols being added to the MRI, perhaps the bony defects and the abnormalities are also picked up quite fantastically on MRI also.
Dr. Sriram, one question from my side. We are seeing a lot of patients of frozen shoulder in the OPD. A lot of patients, right? You think anywhere we can decide on the MR, some finding, this patient will improve with the physio and the regular exercises, medication, or it has to go undergo arthroscopically release of the capsule. Some finding we get in the MR, some specific finding, because 50% chunk patient comes diabetic with frozen shoulder in the OPD sometime. So we just give them medicines and physio. Anything in MR specific?
Yeah, so there's basically one is three locations and second is three stages of frozen shoulder. Locations means that if there is synovial thickening or edema in the rotator interval, axillary pouch, and just posterosuperior to the glenoid rim on the sagittal images, that means it's a full-fledged frozen shoulder. If the edema, if the thickening tends to be very bright on the FSPD images, which means it's an acute inflammatory phase. In such a phase, ideally we should back off. We should not be doing physiotherapy or anything at that stage. The second stage, when it starts going from hyperintense to slightly intermediate, is when the inflammatory stage has gone down. That stage, either of the things can be done. Again, assessment has to be done whether all three areas are involved. So if we see the rotator interval is chinked, if you see that the axillary pouch is very thickened and again chinked, and if you see fluid, there's paucity of glenohumeral joint fluid and fluid only in the biceps tendon sheath and subscapularis recess, then we are basically saying that this patient has adhesive capsulitis. So like I said, the first step is when it's bright. Second step is when it is intermediate, which means slightly between bright and dark. And the third stage, when it is chronic, everything will appear very dark. So that in that stage, usually in chronic adhesive capsulitis, the patient will have terminal limitation of range of movements.
May I ask a question, Dr. Roja?
Yeah, last question.
Dr. Sriram, I often get these reports in which I am primarily suspecting a rotator cuff problem, and then the MRI radiologist reports some problems with the Packard, with the glenoid labrum also. Patient does not have any history of instability. I cannot elicit any signs of instability, but they are very emphatic that there is some labral lesion. I often go in MRI. I do see some fraying, but I'm not sure how to be always interpreting this report in cases which are primarily a rotator cuff problem. So your comments about this finding?
No, are we talking about slap lesions or Bankart lesions?
No, they are Bankart. They are reported in the anterior inferior region.
Okay. And is there any Hill sacs associated with it or not?
No Hill sacs. No Hill sacs.
So the reason why sometimes some of these cases are reported. So there are two kinds of cases. One is those cases which are, either micro instability or the patient has subluxation without a gross dislocation. Those are the true positive cases. The false positive cases are those cases in which there is rotator cuff pathology, which is leading to some adhesive capsulitis, which leads to some signal coming in the anteroinferior glenoid labrum. When that signal comes, that is sometimes interpreted as either Bankart lesion or a Hagel lesion, like Dr. Shekhar Srivastava had shown. You need to see whether the U has got converted into a J. A lot of times we see reports in which they just talk about the entire thing appearing very bright, so that means it's probably a Hagel lesion. And those are actually adhesive capsulitis, and they're not proper Bankart lesions. Having said that, if you see a cleft between the cartilage and the labrum, anteroinferiorly, and you still feel that it's not matching your clinical picture. If the patient's not unstable, I would say that, for example, suppose in my shoulder and the radiologist says that there is some signal coming there. If I'm not unstable, I'm not really going to do anything. But if the there is a risk, you're saying that, okay, cuff mein kuch problem nahi hai, but there's only some signal coming here, then an MR abscram should be done, if, you know, so that we know what is going on.
Right. Thank you so much, sir. We are closing this session. Now we are shifting to the next session, spine session. Dr. Bakshi is there. Dr. Bakshi will be speaking on lumbar PIVD and lumbar kinostenosis. Dr. Bakshi, sir, please, sir. Can you share your screen, sir? Yes, sir, we can see your slides, sir.
It's a pleasure for me to be speaking in the Delhi Orthopedic Association's musculoskeletal imaging part. Pradeep is a can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. Doctor, can you put it in slideshow mode, full screen mode?
For some reason, it's not going getting into that.
What do doctor, I do? I'll help you, doctor.
Yeah, tell doctor, me.
In the bottom, can you see a minus sign or magnifying thing in the bottom right corner?
Can I go to the slideshow?
Doctor, no, note that. Doctor, in the bottom, in the doctor, in the boat. Yeah.
Is this fine now?
Yeah, this is fine, doctor. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I thank my friend and colleague in the hospital, Dr. Pradeep Bageja, and the Delhi Orthopedic Association for inviting me to give a talk on something which is so common, PIVD and lumbar canal stenosis. We typically get almost 30% of our work is on spine, leaving aside brain, etc. What's the agenda today? We must understand, first of all, the normal MRI anatomy. We'll discuss some of the sequences and protocol. We'll also discuss something about this nomenclature. And we'll also talk about spinal canal stenosis and grading. Let me tell you something in the beginning. Now, this is the crucial area that what we are concerned is this little area, that oval kind of a window that you see. Now, this is between the two vertebrae and plates, along with the intervertebral disc, with the pedicles at the top, at the bottom, and, you know, the posteriorly facet joints. Now, all these are responsible in so many ways because they bear 70% of the weight transmission is through the anterior aspect, and 30% of the weight transmission is from the posterior aspect. And now, once I say that weight transmission, now that could be normal, could be abnormal, and what we typically see is that in lying down position, the weight transmission is the least. And while standing, the weight transmission is the maximum. And it results on some kind of effects on the vertebral end plates, along with that on the discs. Just typically, what sequences we choose to use, T1 weighted sagittal, T2 weighted sagittal, we typically plan our study in the sagittal views for the axial scans. We go parallel to the disc at all the levels, irrespective of the contour of the spine. We have to go parallel, otherwise, you know, we'll be giving some kind of fallacious information. We take T2 axials, we take T1 weighted axials, and we look at the spinal canal, we look at the neural foramina, and try to see what's happening to the nerve roots. Are they appearing as a small dot-like areas, or are they clumped, or are they having some kind of different kind of a configuration? Is there something which is coming? Now, which you look in the center, the central part of the disc is generally slightly bright as compared to the peripheral. This is annulus fibrosus, and this is nucleus pulposus. Nucleus pulposus obviously contains a lot of fluid, therefore it looks a little bright. We typically always take a coronal projection, stern coronal trim. Different people call it in a different manner, different centers. But we typically take this because a lot of pathology in the paraspinal, spinal region can be transmitted into the disc. It could be adherent to the vertebral bodies. The infection could travel down along the psoas muscles. So we need to be very careful, and we take one coronal projection, at least in the theorem projections. What we do, we also take a 3D sequence through the spine, just to, you know, be very sure of any kind of cystic lesion within the spinal canal or having some kind of a disc fragment there. So, you know, migrated disc fragments or cysts, etc., are best seen on the T2 space sequence. This is a three-dimensional sequence. Now, so many times we do have confusions because the T1 and T2 weighted images, they give us a doubt as if, you know, there is something going on in the spine. So we need additional sequences such as diffusion weighted sequence, because this can differentiate between type 1 modic process versus early spondylodiscitis. We know that infections, they typically will show some kind of restriction, diffusion restriction, and their behavior would be entirely different from that of normal T1 weighted, T2 weighted images. Suspected spondyloarthropathy, we do take a sagittal theorem or Sturr image just to see what is happening close to the end plates, and then look into the disc. Is the disc showing reduction in signal intensity, or is it showing normal bright kind of a signal that we are seeing? And of course, we have for sequestered segments and differentiating them from the disc, from the tumors, we need to do a contrast and end study. What do we do? The moment we give contrast, the periphery of the sequestered disc will show enhancement. While this disc, if it's a sequestered disc only, it will not show. The tumor will show enhancement in totality. Now, very many times you have a spine which is crooked, which is scoliotic, kyphotic. Now, what do you do? Because there are a lot of changes that you can see in the paraspinal region here, you also want to see that if you can do a direct sagittal plane from this kind of a spine. You do a sagittal view, and then you don't get a very good idea about the disc. So what do? We do a curved multiplanar reconstruction of the T2 weighted sagittal image. This is the T2 weighted sagittal image. We take this image and take multiplanar reconstructions from that. Now, typically in the post-processing, we also use a coronal MIP. Why? Because we can see the nerve roots. We can see the nerve roots coming out and descending downwards. But if you look at on the other side, well, this is a nerve root which is swollen, and you can see the entire course of the nerve root downwards. Now, this is a swollen nerve root. We could only pick it up because we did a post-processing on turbo inversion recovery imaging coronal MIP. Now, what do we have? Typically, we have a very good problem that we are not able to find out whether this is typically L5 or not. If you have not done a complete scan, you don't know the C2 vertebral body, and you can't count the vertebral bodies, then you typically transitional vertebra, or is it really L5? So you want to be sure about it. Typically, we have some landmarks. We have the renal vessels at L1, L2 level, and we have the ileo transverse ligament extending from the iliac blade towards the transverse process of L5. So we know that, yes, if this ligament is seen, or the vessels can be seen, we can identify, yes, this is L1, L2 level. Now, based on that, we can, yes, tell that this is an L5 vertebral body, etc. Typically, what happens? What is normal and abnormal disc? A normal disc has a uniform high signal intensity in the central part, the nucleus, on T2 weighted images. So there could be a central low signal intensity line, high intensity in the central part of the nucleus, and low intensity in the peripheral part can be seen at times. Homogeneous low signal intensity with no distinction between the nucleus and the annulus means it's a dehydrated disc. Look at this disc. You find that the central part is completely dehydrated. It's become dark on the outer side as well as on the superior and inferior aspect. And if you look at this, you find that there is something going on. Something wrong has happened in this disc. Now, if we see at this, This is peripheral circumferential preserved longitudinal fibers. You can see that they are all intact and there's nothing wrong with that. And if you look at that, there's a torn longitudinal fibers and there's a kind of a radial tear resulting into T2 high intensity zone in the annulus fibrosus. This is normally, annulus fibrosus is a low signal intensity area. So if you find this kind of a thing, then that thing you start suspecting radial tear. You can have a completely low signal intensity in the whole of the disc and you might find something going out of the disc in this region. So it's a dehydrated disc and you have to be very careful. Now, what are the modic end plate degenerative changes? Now, typically on T1 weighted, if there's a low signal intensity and on T2, there is a hyper intense signal intensity, unfortunately, this window is coming on the right hand panel. Anyway, I hope you people can see it. So, and what is happening is that this T2 hyper intensity along the end plate shows that yes, on T1 it is hyper and T2 it is hyper. It's basically denoting edema. But if you had something which was bright on both T1 and T2 weighted images, it's fat. The fat does not show any kind of change in signal intensity between T1 and T2. It continues to remain bright. If this, both the endplates showed low signal intensity, they are dark, both on T1 and T2 weighted images, that means there is evidence of fibrosis. So it's a kind of a type 3 disc. Typically, you might also see a claw sign, which is typically you can close to the end place, you find hyper intense signal intensity and the central part of the disc showing low signal intensity. Positive claw sign favors degenerative changes rather than any kind of spondylodiscitis. In case if you have suspicion based on T1, T2 weighted and STIR images, you find that there could be a possibility of early spondylodiscitis, please do a diffusion weighted image and you will be rewarded. Let's understand some of the disc anatomy, disc zones. The disc zones are central zone is there, the disc has a central zone, there is a subarticular zone, and then there is a foraminal zone, and then there is an extra foraminal zone in this part of the far laterally outside. Now, if you look at the cauda equina, it's centrally placed in the spinal canal, but the lateralmost part of the traversing nerve root descends downwards and it extends into the foramen and results into a kind of a foraminal course is there for this disc. And then extra foraminal course is seen outside the foramen. Now, what do we have? We have a central canal zone, which shows that there is a complete posterior central disc herniation. We don't know what to call, whether this is a protrusion or extrusion. We'll denote it in a second. Then we have the extra foraminal zone, we far lateral disc, foraminal zone, and then we have a subarticular zone. Now, what do? When the dome of the disc is larger than the base of the disc, more than 25% is the central part here. This is disc protrusion. Now, when the moment this dome becomes larger than the base, it becomes extrusion. Protrusion changes into sequestration. We have the sequestration on the opposite side. You can see that this is there, well defined. Now, so we have a disc displacement. It could be diffuse, it could be focal. If it's a diffuse disc bulge and there is the disc height is preserved, it is just a disc bulge. Don't call it herniation. This is disc bulge. If there is a kind of a annular bulge, then the disc height would be reduced. But on the other hand, there could be focal herniation, which could be protrusion, as I showed you, that the base is wider than the dome, and there could be extrusion of the disc where the dome is bigger than the base. And then you could have migrated, sequestrated kind of a disc as well. Disc bulge is more than 50, if it is occupying more than 50% of the circumference, it's a diffuse bulge. it's mildly phasing this central canal and the CSF space, and you can see that, yes, this is occupying the central canal as well as the neural foramen and neural canals on both sides. No ligamentum flavum hypertrophy is seen in this. Now, if you look at this, it's an asymmetrical bulge. There's an asymmetrical bulge in, and this results into complete narrowing and knocking down of the neural foramina. And if you look at the central canal, the nerve roots also appear somewhat clumped. So you have to give cognizance to the entire thing. The, what is happening to the nerve roots? Can I see the left-sided neural canal? Yes, I can. I can see the nerve root also going out very nicely, but I can't see the right neural canal as well as the right neural foramina. This protrusion, if it is less than 25% of the circumference base compared to the dome, it is protrusion. If it is posterior central protrusion with mild effacement of the thecal sac can happen, as we can see here. The base is wider. This you have to see that, and the dome is smaller. Now, you can also have a disc extrusion. It can have two fragments. This is one fragment, and you can see the other fragment. Now, you have to be careful whether this fragment that is seen is of the same signal or is it having some kind of a slightly different signal. And you have to also see whether the posterior longitudinal ligament, which was coming from above downwards, has that been torn? And if that would be torn, you will find that this signal of the disc would be slightly different from the signal of the disc, which is above that. So left paracentral disc extrusion, migrated disc material impinging on the left neural foramina. Well, so many times we have seen that toothpaste kind of a sign, you find that the disc material is coming out of the disc, height is reduced, you find that disc component is there, the posterior aspect, low signal intensity, then you find that intermediate signal intensity hanging down in the canal. Now, this is a typical toothpaste sign, but then you could have, this is another thing that I was trying to tell you, that the signal intensity of this disc compared to this disc is entirely different. Now, once you look at this, the thecal sac shows compression and the disc fragment is almost in close proximity to the ligamentum flavum on this side. So extruded, sequestrated discs can lie anywhere in the canal, and their position should not deter you to make a diagnosis of an extruded disc. An extruded, inferiorly migrated, sequestrated fragment, not in continuity with the parent disc, and it can be seen at a different level altogether. This sometimes the upper disc can go up to the lower intervertebral disc level, and one has to be very careful when calling that, as this is the kind of a migration that can take. Migration can take reverse way also. It can go up also. So the disc can migrate superiorly as well as inferiorly. Now, double fragment sign, that's what we were talking about a little while ago. You can see the fragment here, and you can see another component anteriorly. And you can see that, look at this, and you can see that hyperintense area, which is a tear in the annulus, as well as, this the component of the disc which is extruded, and the disc fragment has migrated within the spinal canal. And if you would have taken sections down below, this would have continued going downwards. The migrated disc can be displaced anywhere in the spinal canal. So you have to look for it in the neural foramina. You can see it, whether it is in the superior, inferior, or is it causing any kind of compression of the neural foramina. Or it could also, the patients can present with neurogenic claudication. When they present with neurogenic claudication, you have to look at the spinal canal and you have to look at the neural foramen. You can hardly see the central canal. You can hardly see the neural foramina on the two sides. So why? Because this is because of the disc and plate osteophytic projection and facet joint arthropathy, and the foramen is also narrowed. So when you see all these things in a sagittal and axial planes, then take an MR myelogram. An MR myelogram will typically show you a complete cutoff of the CSF space column both at the levels wherever the disc has extruded and migrated inferiorly. Another case where we see multi-level variable spinal stenosis, we feel that yes, there is significant indentation here. We are sure that this is spinal canal is significantly narrowed. So typically we begin every scan with taking an MR myelogram. We look out for the K areas which appear to be typically at times, you know, there could be some areas which are showing some thread-like areas, but which are conglomerated kind of thing. We don't know whether there's AV malformation there or not. But typically this is because of chemical-shaped artifact, and these things can be clumped together in that particular given zone. But typically what you would see, if you take T2 axial or something, another plane, you'll find signal void to be showing the vascular malformation. This is another case where we find that there is a far lateral...
Last 3 minutes, sir. Dr. Bakshi, sir. Last 3 minutes, sir.
I'm just going to finish it. So this is the foraminal disc, far lateral. This is another case where the nerve root is all swollen. Well, typical reduction in height, end plate changes, and, you know, spinal canal narrowing and the disc extrusion there. So what do we see? Spinal canal stenosis can be because of disc, can be due to facets, can be due to spondylolisthesis, can be because of hypertrophic ligamentum flavor. Don't go on these numerical numbers, please, because typically we find that numerical numbers are the ones that we are used to, that this is it's a visual impression that is there. So you have to see if there is CSF effacement, mild effacement, or is this aggregation of the nerve roots? What kind of, you know, like in this case, there is aggregation of the nerve roots. You know that spinal canal stenosis is significant. And so the same goes with neural foramina. We can see that the disc fragments, and we have to define whether it's a disc disease or it's a posterior element disease. So what's the take-home message? MRI is an important tool to confirm diagnosis of lumbar canal stenosis as a cause of neurogenic claudication. A standard terminology has to be used by the radiologists, orthopedic surgeons, and everybody, so that we are on the same page. Visual grading of stenosis should be done rather than based on absolute cutoff values. Radio-clinical correlation should be done to ascertain the culprit, whatever is there at multiple level stenosis before surgical planning. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. So well elaboration of the PIVD and lumbar canal stenosis. We'll take the question after the second talk. Dr. Guraj, please.
Sir, can you unshare your screen?
Dr. Bakshi, sir, you do, sir. Dr. Guraj, please.
Thank you. At the outset, I would like to thank Dr. Lalit Maini, sir, and Dr. Bageja, and Dr. Hitesh Lal, and Delhi Orthopedic Association for giving me this opportunity to be amongst all the esteemed faculty. So I'm going to present today on spondylolisthesis. So it's going to be mainly on a practical perspective and a surgeon perspective, how you interpret your images. So can you see my slides?
Yes. Please go ahead.
So why do we do imaging as a clinician? So we want to do imaging because we want to diagnose the condition, and we want to do classification mainly for the communication and to decide the treatment and for the documentation. So as a clinician, you always look at imaging with these aspects. But before looking at imaging, our mind should know what should we look at it and what we want to know. What mind doesn't know, mind doesn't see it. So that is why you should know what to expect out of your imaging. Then only you will pick up the findings. So spondylolisthesis, we all know spondylo means basically a slip. Spondylo means vertebra, and listhesis means slip. So that is what spondylolisthesis is, a slip of a vertebra. It can be anterior slip, it can be a posterior slip, and it can be a lateral slip, which we call it as antrolisthesis, retrolisthesis, and lateral olisthesis, respectively. So another two important terminologies we should understand before we go into that. That is, one is spondylolysis, that is a defect in the bars of the vertebra. And spondyloptosis is when the vertebra falls below completely from the below vertebra. That is, this line, the blue line which is drawn here, is called as a Gaines line. This is drawn parallel to the S1 dome. And then if your L5 is falling below that, then it is called as spondyloptosis. So we all know that this basic imaging, because when it comes to spondylolisthesis, it's an alignment which is important. So we need to understand what is a normal alignment before we jump on to understanding abnormal alignment that exists in a spondylolisthesis. So this is the star area which we have marked. That's the pars. So that is the important area when it comes to cases of listhesis. So that's the normal alignment. When you draw a line onto the posterior border of the vertebra, it forms a harmonious lordotic line there. But most of the times we have seen our x-rays that you see a double edge of the posterior vertebral body. So that is because the vertebral body have rotated. That's not a dead lateral x-ray. So then once you mark both the lines and take the midpoint, and then if that forms again a harmonious line, then there is no slip or there is no listhesis. And then alternatively, you can follow is a anterior vertebral body points and follow them to see that they are in one harmonious line. If there is no break in the this harmonious line, so then we say it as a normal alignment. So then when it comes to spondylolisthesis, there are other two special views. That is, one is right oblique view and left oblique view to see basically the lysis which is there in the pars. So this is a sign of a Scottish right ear dog. So we call it as a Scottish dog. So we have to understand what are the part of this. This T is transverse process, that is, and then the eye is made of pedicle, and the ear is made of a superior facet, and the legs are made of inferior facet. So you have to understand, and then this is the neck is the pars. So this is again a very important view when it comes to listhesis. So then other important views are dynamic views, that is lateral flexion extension views, to see basically instability which exists in spondylolisthesis. If you see here, in a flexion, the vertebral body is moving ahead, and in extension, it is coming back. It clearly demonstrates instability. And with the recent advancements and with the understanding of the spinopelvic harmonious balance and sagittal balance being given more important as compared to the coronal balance, so these views, that is whole spine radiographs, become very important when it comes to management of spondylolisthesis. So whenever you manage the spondylolisthesis, you should at least try to have these views for an ideal case scenario. Then, as we were talking, the spondylolisthesis, this is an antrolisthesis. You can see that there's a break in this harmonious line. There's again break here. This is a retrolisthesis. You can see there are multiple level listhesis happening in one spine. So the famous grading, which we commonly use, is a Meyerding's grading. So it depends upon how much the vertebral body above is slipping on the vertebral body below on the percentage basis. So grade 1 is 25%, grade 2 is 25 to 50, grade 3 is 50 to 75, and grade 4 is 75 to 100, and then grade 5 is when it is completely gone ahead and going into the pelvis, or it's below the Gaines line. It's called as grade 5 or spondyloptosis. So whenever we manage these cases, it's very, very pertinent to document a progression. So, but to document a progression, you have to take x-rays or radiographs in a same position and the same angles. Otherwise, the slip grading becomes difficult. If you see this same x-ray is taken 2 years apart. You can see that L5-S1 disc is also getting narrowed. Its degenerative process is ongoing and the listhesis is progressing. And when it comes to CT, CT is very important. We all know that it gives us a very good bony anatomy. So what you have to look in a CT, that is when it comes to spondylolisthesis, pars anatomy, very, very important. Facetal arthropathies, pedicle anatomy, because pedicles can be narrow, really nearly narrow when it comes to high-grade spondylolisthesis. Calcified discs, basically again, classification of the listhesis based on the CT grading, vacuum signs, which gives you a basically an idea of instability. You can have degenerative scoliosis. And basically, this is very important when it comes to lytic listhesis or a degen listhesis, where superior facet might be jutting into the foramen, where you have to specifically look in and decompress. So coming to one by one, that's degenerative spondylolisthesis. We all know that it's a primarily due to disc and facet degeneration, and the listhesis develops due to facet joint instability. And secondary listhesis can happen adjacent to a fused, already fused segment. So that's the two examples. This is a primary listhesis at L4-5, and that's a this is a fused spine, and the secondary listhesis happening at L3-4. So what do you look at in radiographs when it comes to degenerative spondylolisthesis? That you see that the disc height is reducing, you can have these vacuum signs, and there are osteophytic spurs, and basically they can be there anteriorly and posteriorly both. So you see the degenerative basically signs in the X-rays. And then when it comes to spondylolisthesis management, whether to fuse it or not, the instability parts become really, really important. So degenerative spondylolisthesis can have two types of instability, that is translational instability, and other thing is the angular instability. So translational instability, whenever from a dynamic view, if a vertebral body is moving more than 4 millimeters, we call it as an unstable spine. But then this value differs from level to level in a lumbar spine. But for all practical purposes, we take it as 4 mm movement as an unstable spine. Again, this is an example of an angular instability. So if change of more than 10 degree angulation, again, there are different values at different levels, but for practical purpose, we can take it as more than 10 degree change in the angulation is taken as an angular instability when it comes to degenerative spine. So what else you should look? Basically, when it comes to degenerative spondylolisthesis, we can have something like this. What is this? This is a pseudo disc bulge. So it's not really a slip disc, but it's a pseudo disc bulge. But we can have a frank slip discs associated with listhesis. So you have to differentiate between pseudo and a frank slip disc happening in a spondylolisthesis, because the treatment differs, especially in degenerative spondylolisthesis. Because in degenerative spondylolisthesis, most of the times they are stable. We tend to only do decompressions. But when you do decompression, if you do a discectomy, then you are going to create instability. So that is why you have to differentiate between a pseudo disc bulge and a frank or actual slip disc. And then what you have to see is the central canal stenosis and then the foraminal stenosis. So again, we know that in degenerative spondylolisthesis, usually the exiting nerve root is spared. With the advent of spinal surgery, more and more we are doing endoscopic and minimal access surgeries with tubular retractors. So you tend to stick to a pathological area which is causing the problems. So you need to study your MRI properly, study all the foramens, whether in this case the nerve root is compromised here, but here it is not compromised. So study your MRI properly into the foramen and see whether you need to go ahead and decompress these foramens. Then this is again very, very important. You see this MRI and there is no listhesis here. But then don't miss this kind of facet effusion. If the effusion is more than 1 millimeter, you should have suspicious that there can be a listhesis happening with the weight bearing. So this case, these cases need fusion. So this is the same case with the flexion extension. You can see that there is a listhesis which is happening. So don't miss facetal effusions. And again, what you shouldn't miss in these cases is a facet cyst, because facet cyst is a sign of, again, an instability. So all facet cysts don't need fusion, but then if it is really big and coming out directly from the joint, connected to the joint still, so they all need a fusion. Then another important factor which we have to see is a facet tropism when it comes to degenerative spondylolisthesis. So how does basically facetal alignment matters when it comes to management of degenerative spondylolisthesis, because it guides your treatment whether you will fuse or you will just do a decompression. So these facets are sagittally oriented, these facets are coronally oriented. So how does that make difference? This is a sagittally oriented facet, this is a coronally oriented facet. So if there is an angle is more than 45 degrees, there is 25 times more likely that the listhesis is going to progress. So you need to fuse when there is a sagittally oriented facet. Why is that? Because there is a this portion which is causing the buttressing effect, which doesn't allow it to slip. But typically when we do our decompressions, we take out some part of the superior facet. So what happens is you take away this buttressing effect and causing it to slip, progress. So that is why you have to see for this alignment when it comes to management of degenerative spondylolisthesis. This is a coronal facets. The buttressing effect still remains after decompression. Coming to lytic spondylolisthesis, what is lysis? We were already discussing break in the pars intraarticularis. So again, we cannot forget famous Scotty dog. So you can see this, both scenarios exist in the same spine. This is a lysis with the basically broken leg, broken neck. And then this is a collar appearance where there is a lysis is mild. So this is a broken neck and this is a collar of the Scottish dog. And when it comes to, again, lytic spondylolisthesis, you can also appreciate this is this step, absence of this harmonious line along the ends of the spinous processes. You can see this step developing there, especially.
The last 3 minutes we have.
Yes, sir. I'll finish. So, again, when it comes to instability, the angular instability is very much pronounced in lytic spondylolisthesis. So, there's one more rotational instability exists in whenever it is a lytic spondylolisthesis. You have to see that the spinous process is rotated. It also shows that there is an instability happening there. And then this is a pseudoscoliosis in a case of a listhesis. So don't mistake it to be a real scoliosis and try to treat scoliosis. If you just treat your lytic listhesis, your scoliosis gets corrected automatically. And then you can have dysplastic anatomy. You can have a bifid spinous processes. You can have hypoplastic pars and hypoplastic posterior elements. When it comes to CT, CT is a choice. CT is investigation of choice to diagnose a lytic listhesis or a lysis. You can see that clearly with lysis happening in this image. There is MRI also. If you look at carefully, you can see the lysis. And in stir images, especially if it is a traumatic type or it's a fresh lysis, you can appreciate very well. There are some indirect signs of lysis. The canal is elongated anteroposteriorly. Then again, you should suspect there is a lysis. Or there are sometimes there is a reactive hyperemia into the adjacent pedicle. Again, you have to suspect lysis in those cases and investigate further. So again, here you see the exiting nerve root is always compromised when it comes to lytic listhesis, and you have to always address that nerve root. Coming to high-grade spondylolisthesis, grade 2 and above, we call them high-grade spondylolisthesis. So this is a famous inverted Napoleon hat sign, which is described for high-grade spondylolisthesis. And again, dynamic X-rays are important, but not only the flexion and extension X-rays. Prone lateral view is important when it comes to high-grade spondylolisthesis, because this is the one which demonstrates how much it is reducible when it comes to positioning on the OT table. And then you have to see these dysplastic signs, that is trapezoidal shape of L5 and doming of the S1 and vertical orientation of the sacrum. And there is a junctional kyphosis and elongated and narrow pedicles. These are the dysplastic listhesis. And you have to be careful in managing these cases. Again, high-grade spondylolisthesis can present with scoliosis. And you have to examine your CTs very carefully, because the pedicles can be very, very narrow at L5 S1 high-grade spondylolisthesis, especially L5 pedicles. You see here, the pedicles are almost non-existent. So you have to be careful when you put your screws into these pedicles. And then when you reduce these listhesis, you have to be very careful, be careful about this ossification of the traction spur, and you have to always take out this, otherwise this will cause problems. And then we all know that with high rates, this pelvis gets retroverted because of the hyperlordotic lumbar spine. So these parameters become very important, and try to measure them before managing any high-grade spondylolisthesis. That is, slip angle more than 60 degrees actually indicates that this listhesis is really going to progress fast, and you have to measure pelvic tilt and pelvic incidence and accordingly manage high-grade spondylolisthesis. This is a classification which is based on these parameters, and type 6 unbalanced spine requires always reduction, and type 4 balanced pelvis doesn't need reduction. So that is why the whole spine X-rays are important when it comes to especially high-grade spondylolisthesis, because high-grade spondylolisthesis is a deformity surgery. It is not a normal surgery. Thank you.
Thank you to Dr. Gururaj for completion on time. Sessions open for discussion. Any questions from the faculty, please? So talks are so clear, no question, no confusion. So if there is no talk, any question from the
recording
faculty?
Stopped. Recording anyway, in
thank
progress.
Thank you so much, Dr. Bakshi sir and Dr. Gururaj, for the wonderful talks and explaining all the things. So we'll move to the next session. That is on DEXA scan by Dr. Ritu Verma. Dr. Ritu. Please share here. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for this opportunity. My talk for today is bone densitometry and its interpretation in osteoporosis. Although it's a very fairly easy topic, but still the implications are vast, because osteoporosis is a problem that is global, and if we don't address it at the early stage, it may lead to increased propensity to fractures and thus increasing morbidity and sometimes mortality as well. So let's start with the structure of a normal bone. The majority of bone is made up of matrix, and the difference between matrix of bone and that of other cells is that the matrix of bone is hard, which is made up of inorganic as well as organic parts. The inorganic part consists of calcium hydroxyapatite, and the organic part of matrix is mainly composed of type 1 collagen, also composed of various growth factors like glycosaminoglycans, osteocalcin, osteonectin, osteopontin, and cell attachment factor. So this, there are several types of cells which constitute the bone, and osteoblasts are the precursor cells, precursor of both osteocytes as well as osteoclasts. These are cells which are the which lay down the matrix as unmineralized osteoid. They also produce alkaline phosphatase, which helps in mineralization of bone. And osteocytes are mature cells which help in matrix maintenance and calcium homeostasis. And osteoclasts are the cells which are responsible for bone resorption. And new bone are formed by the osteoblasts and osteocytes. So basically, the pathology behind osteoporosis is an imbalance between osteoblastic and osteoclastic activity. The existing bone is reabsorbed faster than new bone is made. As this occurs, the bone loses minerals and mass and structure, making them less dense, weaker, and thus increasing the risk of fractures. So this is how a normal bone looks like, quite compact here, but with osteoporosis, it becomes weaker. It loses minerals and becomes porous, and thus weaker with increased susceptibility to fractures. As we age, normally also, the peak bone mass is achieved by the age of 25. And after the age of 30, we start losing our bones faster than we replace it. So with increasing age, the bone resorption process becomes faster than the bone formation process that results in increasing osteopenia. So osteopenia refers to bone mineral density that is lower than normal peak bone mass, that is between -1 and -2.5. By standard, by WHO standard, if the bone mass is less than -2.5, it is considered osteoporosis, but between -1 and -2.5, it is considered as osteopenia. So osteopenia is usually a sign of normal aging, but osteoporosis is a sign of pathologic aging, and it occurs more frequently in postmenopausal women because estrogen plays a very important role in calcium homeostasis and bone formation. And it can be exacerbated by lifestyle modifiable factors such as lack of exercise, alcoholism, smoking, or prolonged use of steroids. So osteopenia usually has no symptoms. There is no pain as the bone becomes thinner, but the risk of fracture gradually increases as the bone becomes less dense. The diagnosis of osteopenia as well as osteoporosis is by bone mineral density test. A standard X-ray is not useful in diagnosing because it is not sensitive enough to detect small amounts of bone loss or minor changes in bone density. So, as I said, by WHO standards, osteoporosis is defined as bone density that is less than 2.5 standard deviations below the mean bone mass of an average young healthy adult, age group 25 to 30. The underlying mechanism in osteoporosis is an imbalance between bone resorption and new bone formation. There are various major and minor risk factors. A major risk factor is age, both in men and women. And in women, again, menopause is a major risk factor. Other risk factors are prolonged steroid intake, hypogonadism, a propensity to fall, fragility factors after age 40, family history, and minor modifiable risk factors like alcoholism, smoking, excessive caffeine intake, excess body weight, or excessive weight loss. So menopause has a very important role in osteoporosis. If a diet is low in calcium, and with menopause, when there is decrease in estrogen, both of these play a role in resulting in osteoporosis when there is the calcium deficiency slows down new bone formation, and estrogen deficiency causes increased bone loss, resulting in thin, brittle, osteoporotic bones. So bone mineral density is measured, bone mineral mass is used to measure bone mineral density. A BMD test is used to measure bone mineral mass, and it determines the risk of future fractures. It also can monitor bone changes associated with treatment, so very important in follow-up. It is safe, non-invasive, and painless. The test is easy and requires no special preparations on patient part. It measures the density of bones. It detects osteoporosis before a fracture occurs, helps to predict chances of fracture in the future, and it can also monitor the effectiveness of treatment offered. There are several ways to measure BMD. Dual energy X-ray absorptiometry is the most commonly used, which is there in our department as well. The other modes are peripheral dual energy X-ray absorptiometry, which is also called PDEXA, dual photon absorptiometry, quantitative computer tomography, and quantitative ultrasound. A bone scan is quite different from bone mineral density test. And bone scan is an invasive test. The patient is injected with a dye. It is a very common mistake that sometimes occurs. The doctors sometimes write bone mineral density. So whenever you are asking for osteoporosis or a hint of osteopenia in the body, you ask for bone mineral density test. And bone scan usually looks for inflammation, fractures, and other mitotic lesions of the bone. It cannot predict the risk of osteoporosis, although there are signs on bone scan which points towards an underlying metabolic bone disease. But BMD can assess the bone mineral mass in a much better way. Peripheral DEXA is a type of DEXA which is quite commonly done, but the fallacies are it cannot be used for monitoring the treatment of osteoporosis because PDEXA usually measures the bone density of peripheral bones, mainly the wrists or calcaneum, And whenever the following treatment, the changes occur more centrally, that is in the axial skeleton, and the changes in the peripheral skeleton come much later. Dual energy absorptiometry, that is the DEXA scan, is the most accurate and standardized way to measure BMD. It uses two different X-ray beams to estimate bone density in the spine and hip. It's quick, easy, and painless. And a low-dose X-ray is used, which is only 10% of the radiation exposure of a chest X-ray. So the radiation dose is very less. So there are two X-ray beams of two different energy which pass through the body. One peak gets absorbed by the soft tissue and another peak gets absorbed by the bones. So we get an image where there is a two-dimensional image, and the soft tissue amount is subtracted from the total area, giving the bone mineral density. And these measurements are then compared with the normal ranges matched for chronological age. And that's how we achieve the T-scores and the Z-scores. So we must understand what is a T-score and what is a Z-score. T-score actually compares your bone density with that of a standard person of the same gender, age group 25 to 30. And the scores of osteopenia, mild, moderate, severe, and osteoporosis are given on the T-scores. Z-score is the bone mineral, your bone mineral density being compared to a person of your age and gender. And it is usually relevant in children and very young adults where the T-score has not yet been achieved. So for all practical purposes in adults, the T-score is what is used for treatment follow-up as well as for definition of osteopenia and osteoporosis. So we considered plus minus one as the baseline bone mineral mass, and anything below that, we start grading them as mild to moderate to severe osteopenia, and below minus 2.5 becomes osteoporosis. So this is a DEXA scanner which has a mobile arm which slides over the body and takes measurements. The results come in this form. This is of the hip and this is of the lumbar spine. We get three values here. If we see this, the first value is the absolute bone mass in gram per centimeter square. Second value is the T-score, and the third value is the Z-score. So for all adults, the T-score is the most valuable. But in cases where we are following a person after treatment, sometimes we may have to look at the bone mineral mass, absolute bone mineral mass, because the T-score may remain the same or may have very slight difference, but with increasing effectiveness of treatment, the bone absolute bone mineral mass may increase, and thus showing efficacy of the treatment. Along with bone mineral density measured at different sites, we also have a fracture risk assessment tool, which is the FRAX tool. This FRAX tool is used to assess 10-year probability of fracture and gives us the FRISC score. FRISC score is the 10-year probability of a fracture based on the FRAX tool. So this tool actually takes into account, along with bone mineral density, the ethnicity, the height, weight, and other demographic data, as well as history of steroid or other drug intake into account, and gives us a score which is termed as the FRISC score. And on the basis of the FRISC score, the 10-year probability of fracture is assessed. So we can see that doing a DEXA, we can also assess the fracture risk. And here in this graph, we see that with increasing age and with reducing bone mass, the risk of fracture increases. So in women, risk of fracture increases in the postmenopausal age group progressively, steadily progresses in the after 50 age group. Whereas in men, the risk last is almost steady as at 70. Yes, sir. I'll stick to my time, sir. Oh, yeah. And in men, up till the age of 70, the risk is almost stable, but after 70, it progressively increases. So we categorize the risk as low, moderate, and high, depending on the fracture risk. The T-scores are unitless, and it is the basis of majority of osteoporosis guidelines, and it is useful because it's simple, and it can be used for treatment assessment. Disadvantages are it is dependent on the site measured, on technology, and depends on the reference database. For example, we don't have a reference database for very young children, so the T-scores are not valid there. So who needs treatment? Anyone who is diagnosed with osteoporosis, that is T-score of less than 2.5, with increase with a history of fragility fracture, that would be a fracture following a trivial trauma. And FRAC score, if it is high, then that means the 10-year probability of fracture is high. So treatment offered, whether it is in the form of stimulators of bone formation or inhibitors of bone resorption, whatever the treatment prescribed, one has to stick to it because drugs don't work in people that don't take them. So now comes to screening with DEXA. Who should be screened? Women, all post-women, menopausal women and men older than 70. Again, younger people should also be screened if they have risk factors, which may result in osteoporosis. This is my last slide. What are the contraindications for BMD tests? There are very few contraindications, pregnancy being one. Any recent GI contrast studies, because it hampers with the BMD assessment of the lumbar spine. Again, BMD assessment of the hip can still be done. It is recommended to wait for at least 72 hours if a positive oral contrast has been given. Bilateral hip replacement or bilateral hip pins or metallic rods or in the spine may hamper the BMD assessment there. But if a metallic prosthesis is in place, another site can be assessed. So thank you. So this is all about bone mineral density.
Thank you, madam. You. We have some questions for you.
Yes, sir.
What is the cut off values in children, Z-scores and T-scores?
As I said, T-score is not valid for children because the children, the process of developing the peak bone mass, it keeps occurring till the age of 25 almost. So less than 25, T-scores are not generated. So we take Z-scores into consideration and very small children, less than 10 years of age, even the Z-scores are not available because we don't have the relevant database. So what we go by generally in people who have a genetic propensity for osteoporosis, we go by the absolute bone mineral mass and compare it with, there are several databases available in literature where they have given absolute bone mass in different age groups, in different pediatric age groups. We compare the data with those age groups and call them whether it is below normal or above normal or whatever it is compared to the absolute bone mass.
So for children, we are doing absolute bone mass, no score.
Absolute
right?
bone mass, less than 10, between 10 to 20 Z scores, above 20 T scores.
Right.
Dr. Bagheja, may I ask a question?
Yeah, please, Dr. Manocha.
Ma'am, you mentioned that sometime even after treatment, T-score remains normal and then absolute bone mass is to be considered in
yes,
those
sir.
Cases. Will you please explain this point more? That because T-score, I have seen sometime, not only it remains the same, it may even fall by a point or so. But then absolute mass in those situations, if it remains the same or just rises by a point, what should be my interpretation of the effect of my treatment?
Sir, what I would like to say that whenever a person undergoes repeated DEXA scans, ideally it should be done at the same test center. If not,
no,
the previous...
I do take care of that. I always yes. get it done at the same center.
Yes, sir. So that what happens is osteoporosis is any value below minus 2.5. So even if the value is minus 3 or minus 3.5, it will still be considered as osteoporosis. So the interpretation would say it's the result is osteoporosis. But if the score has gone up, has risen from minus 3.5 to minus 3, and if the bone mineral mass has increased from maybe 445 to 550, then we would interpret is as improvement in the previous bone mineral density test, and that would mean that the treatment is working. Even if after a particular age, even if the bone mineral mass remains stable, that with treatment, that would also be considered as efficacy of treatment, because say after 65 or 70, if there is no further loss, that would mean that the treatment is working.
Yeah, that's what was I wanted it to be clear. Thank you very much, making us that point clear. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
There's one more question. In adult, two-side DEXA or three-side DEXA, which is better and why?
Sir, two-side DEXA is standard, hip and spine. So, sometimes when there are metallic processes in place, either in the lumbar spine or a hip replacement has been done, bilateral hip replacement, and we can't take the hip into consideration. We can do, but because by standards, the peripheral bones are weaker than the central bones. So the wrist DEXA, whenever you write three-side DEXA, we do hip, spine, and wrist. So when you are suspecting osteoporosis and the hip and lumbar spine are normal, the wrist may still come out to be osteoporotic or osteopenic, because although the lumbar spine responds the fastest to treatment, but the wrist bones, they are their changes are whenever the osteoporosis starts, the changes are earlier in wrist bones. So three-site DEXA has the chance of picking up osteoporosis or osteopenia earlier than central site. So although usually two sites suffice, but three sites would be more accurate in picking up osteoporosis or osteopenia at an earlier age.
And Dr. Bagheja, can I ask a question?
1 minute, sir. Ma'am, sometime in orthopedic practice, people want to reduce the cost of the patient. Two sites is 4,000 rupees and one site is 2,000 rupees. So sometimes what to choose?
Lumbar spine, spine, sir. Lumbar spine.
You always go for lumbar spine first.
Yes, sir.
Out of the two, is it?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Dr. Sharath, please, sir.
Yes, ma'am. When you see the scan of hip, you get number of readings.
Yes,
from
sir.
Neck, from total, from the quartz triangle. What's so in normal situation, which one you take normally?
The lowest value is taken as the final value. The lowest value anywhere. Usually what happens is with age, we do get some degenerative changes in the bones, especially in the lumbar spine, but sometimes in the hip as well. So we divide the areas into segments, and we also provide the segmental absolute values and T-scores. So they're always given at the back of the report as well. We usually assess and we look for the lowest score, and that is considered to be the final result. And whenever we see degenerative changes, we try to mask that area or remove that area from the actual calculation, because it may lead to higher or false negative report, because degenerative changes lead to sclerosis, and that falsely increases the BMD value. So we try to remove that from the picture so that the actual bone density can be revealed. So lowest value always.
Any importance of total hip value? The total hip value is always given.
Sir, if the total value is normal, but still if the Ward's triangle is showing osteopenia or osteoporosis, that should be taken into consideration, sir. Because degenerative changes do affect the joints as well as bones sometime. So the individual, fragile areas or the areas which are more prone for fractures, If BMD is saying that the Ward's triangle is weak, that should be taken into consideration.
Thank you.
The last question again, they are asking how to interpret Z-score between 10 to 25 years of age. Can you repeat that answer?
Z-score between 10 to 20 years of age, usually we'll give you a Z-score. If the Z-score is low, that is, if it is -3, that would mean there is lowering. We can't call it osteoporosis. Osteoporosis, by definition, is in adults. So we would say there is lowering of the bone mineral mass. If it is less than, if it is between -1 and below, less than -1 would be considered a lowering in bone mineral mass. And we would call it as a lowered bone mineral mass and not term it as osteoporosis. Right? Because by definition, you have to compare it with peak bone mass. So we see the Z score if it is -2 or -2.5, or if it is -3, sometimes in hematological disorders, the Z scores are minus 3.5. So we would say there is significant lowering of the bone mineral mass. And in children, usually it is not not used as a single value. It is used in treatment planning and follow-up of treatment. So any increase in Z-score or any improvement in bone mineral mass, that is considered significant on follow-up studies.
Last question to you, ma'am. There's a question from the chat box. For children, what do you advise? What, single site or two sites?
For children, usually a whole body DEXA is advised. Because whole body DEXA. We exclude the skull because skull is very dense. We exclude the skull, that our system does it. But a whole body DEXA scan, because we don't know where the bones have fused and where it has not fused. Depending on the age of the child, we usually do a whole body side DEXA along with a separate measurement of the hip and neck, hip and lumbar spine. So that we come to a coherent result.
Thank you so much, madam. Stay with us till the last session is over.
Thank
because another few questions are coming up after some time. Now we're moving to the last session, the knee session, and everybody is waiting for that. The first talk is by Dr. Mittal sir, Dr. Ravi Mittal sir, all about the meniscus. Dr. Mittal sir. Sir, unmute.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, please.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Bageja. Thank you, Dr. Lalit, Dr. Hitesh, for this invitation. I'll be speaking on imaging of meniscus. Now, since most of the audience is orthopedic surgeons, I'll be speaking from their point of view. Now, the question is, should the surgeon be bothered about the details of an MRI report besides this conclusion, because most of us read only the last two lines of the MRI report. And in the middle of the report, we see something like grade 2 medial meniscus tear in the body of meniscus or grade 3 radial tear in the posterior horn of lateral meniscus. The answer to this is it should bother a surgeon who is keen to save the meniscus, because saving a meniscus involves both time and money. And he has to plan, he has to tell the patient about the increased cost and also the prognosis. So the surgeon wants to know from MRI report, is there a meniscus tear in a definitive yes or no? If yes, what is the site of the tear and what is the pattern? And after knowing this, he is better prepared for the surgery. He can tell the patient of the increased time and prognosis of the surgery. Now, a normal meniscus is best seen in sagittal sections. It has a triangular configuration as marked by red arrows, and it looks black on all segments. A normal meniscus, both lateral and medial meniscus, are shown in the figures below. Now, if you take a sagittal section in the body, it has a bow tie appearance. And if you take a section towards the horns, look like opposing triangles. In a coronal section, the body would like again look like a triangular black triangle. But if you go towards the posterior aspect, you'll see a slab-like configuration which is attaching to the tibia, which is the meniscal root. Now there are only two criteria for meniscal tear. Either we have an increased signal, that means it from black you see something white, and this signal is touching the articular surface of the meniscus, either superior or inferior or both. The other criteria is the change in the shape of the meniscus in the absence of a previous meniscus surgery. So there are only two criteria for diagnosing a meniscal tear. Now, when you read a MRI report, you often see grade 1 and grade 2 meniscal tear. Grade 1 is just a focal intrasubstance high signal as shown in figure X. You see a white dot in the background of black. Grade 2 is linear or diffuse high signal, which is not extending to the articular surface of the meniscus as shown in figure Y. Both grade and grade 1 and 2 are not of surgical importance, because when you do an arthroscopy, you'll see an intact meniscus. Grade 3 is of surgical importance and it shows a white signal which is extending to either of the articular surface or both the articular surface. So if you see the MRI on the right bottom, you see some white signal in the background of black, but it's not extending to the articular surface. So it is grade 2 only. And if you do arthroscopy, you'll not find anything. So if you see grade 1 or 2 report, don't operate these patients. There are various patterns of meniscus tear, but there are three basic types of meniscus tear according to the three planes in the scale, in the space. So they are vertical longitudinal tear, radial tear, and the horizontal tears. And all the other types are combinations of two or three of basic types of tears. So a longitudinal tear is one which divides the meniscus into an inner and an outer part, as shown in the schematic diagram. On the MRI, you can see, you see a white line in the background of black, which divides into a peripheral and the inner part. In the arthroscopy, a vertical and longitudinal tear looks like this when it is towards the free inner border. But if you see this MRI, you see a break here in the meniscus, which is a white line going from top to bottom, very close to the capsular side. Now, if you do arthroscopy, the meniscus looks normal. But if you probe it, you can see a vertical and longitudinal tear and the meniscus can be displaced toward the center of the notch. A bucket handle tear is a subset of a longitudinal tear where there is a medial migration of the medial fragment. Now, if you do a sagittal section, you see a double PCL sign. Now, what causes the double PCL sign is that the blue one, the blue arrow shows the original PCL, and this is the displaced fragment of the medial meniscus which has come towards the notch. Now, in the coronal section, this explains is that the red arrow shows the displaced meniscal fragments in the notch, and the blue arrow shows the residual mass of the medial meniscus. And this is the original PCL. This is again a bucket handle tear, a displaced fragment in the notch. And you see a double PCL sign. And on arthroscopy, you see a meniscus which is present towards the notch. You can reduce this fragment and repair it by any method that you like. A horizontal tear of the meniscus divides into a superior and an inferior part. As shown in the schematic diagram, on arthroscopy, you have a picture like this. And MRI shows a white line going from and in the substance of the meniscus and dividing into the upper and the lower part. Usually, all these tears were either debrided or left as such, but now we are repairing these horizontal tears also. A radial tear is one where the tear divides the meniscus into an anterior and a posterior part. And if you take a section through this part, which doesn't have a sharp inner border, the MRI would give a trapezoidal appearance as shown here. So the triangle becomes a trapezoid. This is a triangle, but this is a trapezoid when the section is taken through this part of the tear. This is the arthroscopic picture of a radial tear. And traditionally, they have been treated by partial meniscectomy. But now these radial tears are also repaired and you can expect good healing in these tears also, even though they are in avascular zone. A parrot beak or a flap tear is a combination of a radial and a vertical longitudinal tear. The tear starts like this in the radial direction and then progresses like a vertical longitudinal tear. The arthroscopic picture looks like this. These are not suitable for repair and they are best managed by partial meniscectomy. A complex meniscus tear is a combination of two or three patterns of tear and you have multiple signals going in different directions. And this is the arthroscopic picture of a complex meniscal tear. They are not suitable for repairs. They are best managed by partial meniscectomy. We come to the posterior root tears. Now, this is a picture of a dissected specimen. The star shows the attachment of the posterior roots of the meniscus to the tibia. So a posterior root tear is a bony or soft tissue posterior root avulsion injury or a radial tear within 1 centimeter of the posterior root attachment. Now, if you take a normal MRI in the coronal view, this is the attachment of the medial meniscus and this is the attachment of the lateral meniscus. And if we, in presence of a root tear, you see a white line which is breaking the continuity of the black meniscus. So this is a cleft sign or a truncation sign denoting a root tear. A normal MRI, the outer border of the medial meniscus is collinear with the medial border of the medial femoral condyle and medial tibial condyle. So they are all in a straight line. But in presence of a root tear, the meniscus extrudes out. So this is called meniscus extrusion. And the outer border of the meniscus is not collinear with the medial border of the tibial condyle or the femoral condyle. So this is an indirect sign of a meniscal root tear. And also you see some osteoarthritis changes in this compartment. So this meniscal root tear is as good as a total meniscectomy biomechanically. And these should be repaired as much as possible. In an axial section, you see a root attachment like this on the medial side, and on the lateral side, you see like this. And if you have a tear of the root, you see a radial linear defect perpendicular to the long axis of meniscus. In a sagittal section, the medial meniscus root looks like a small triangle, and this is the lateral meniscus root attachment on the tibia. So in presence of a root tear, you have a truncated triangle or an absence of a triangle, which is called a ghost meniscus. Arthroscopically, this classification of root tears has been given, where the type 1 is a partial radial root tear, type 2 is a complete radial tear, and this is the commonest variety. Type 3, you have a bucket handle tear. In a type 4, you have an oblique tear rather than a true radial tear. And a type 5, you have a bony avulsion with the root. This classification is applicable both to the lateral and the medial meniscus, and the type 2 is the commonest. So this is a type 2 root tear. You see a meniscus extrusion and you see a linear defect, white fluid signal, and there is a discontinuity of the posterior horn of medial meniscus. So this is a type 2 root tear. Arthroscopically, you can see that this meniscus is not attaching to the tibia. And this is a picture after the repair of the meniscus root. This is again, there is no attachment of the meniscus to the tibia. This is type 2 and this is after repair. Now type 4, this is an oblique tear and this is the arthroscopic picture that you can see. You can repair it by an all-inside technique. So these are the sutures where you pass the suture in this fashion and you pass 2 or 3 sutures to repair the root tear, which is a oblique tear. You can also repair by inside out technique. And this is the type 4 root tear before the repair. And this is after the repair where the sutures have been passed by inside out technique. Type 5 root tear where the root avulses along with a piece of bone. So this is the posterior horn of meniscus, this is the root, and this is the part of the bone which of the tibia which is avulsed, and this is the donor site from the tibia from which it has avulsed. And this is the appearance after the repair. Now we come to a new entity called ramp lesion, relatively new. Now this has a very precise definition that this is a peripheral vertical longitudinal of the posterior horn of medial meniscus, as shown in the figure. And this is due to the meniscocapsular ligament tear, no greater than 2.5 in mediolateral direction. So it's a very small tear and it leads to the meniscocapsular or meniscotibial separation with a concomitant ACL injury. So if there is no ACL injury, you can't label it as a ramp lesion. To explain this, we see a schematic diagram. The black thing is a tibial plateau. The blue is the meniscus, the green is the capsule posteriorly, and the red is the meniscocapsular ligament, and the orange is the meniscotibial. And in between the two, we have some yellow colored fat. So when we see this normal MRI, you see a black meniscus, a black line of the capsule, and in between you have a gray, which denotes fat, and the meniscocapsular and meniscotibial ligament, the fine lines. But you don't see anything white here. That's normal. Again, you see a black meniscus, capsule, gray area of fat, and the ligaments, no white area. In the axial section, you have the black meniscus, nothing white posterior to it. Again, a black meniscus, nothing white posterior to it. So for the ramp lesion, you have primary signs and the secondary sign. Secondary signs are all those of the ACL injury. The primary signs in the sagittal section, you see a white line which is corresponding to the fluid between the red-red zone of the posterior horn of medial meniscus and the posterior medial capsule, which is reaching either the superior, inferior, or the both articular surface. Another sign is when you see the irregularity of the posterior horn of medial meniscus with the discontinuity. This is because when the posterior capsule has detached along with a piece of meniscus along with it. In the axial section, you see some fluid which is posterior to the posterior horn of medial meniscus. In the coronal section, you see some fluid between the medial meniscus and the MCL. Now, this is a MRI of a 30-year-old patient with an ACL tear. You see the meniscus. Now, this meniscus looks all black, has some white signal. So, this is grade 1 or 2. Otherwise, it is intact. But you see the white line between the capsule and the meniscus. So, that indicates a ramp lesion of the medial meniscus. Similarly here, in the sagittal section, you see an intact black meniscus. This is the MCL, and you see some white line that denotes a fluid between the MCL and the medial meniscus. Similarly, on this section also. Now, if you do arthroscopy, posteriorly you see this is the ramp lesion. This is the, you can see the tibia between the tear. You see from posterior side, and when you see from the anterior portal, you see a defect like this. These are very important to be repaired. They contribute to the stability of the meniscus. You can pass sutures like this, and final repair is like this. So this was the tear, and this is the appearance after the repair.
Dr. Mitchell, so last 3 minutes you have.
MRI is very useful to know the presence of a tear, pattern of a tear, and you can plan your surgery according to the meniscus appearance on MRI. And I suggest that one should go back to MRI images after doing arthroscopy, because this is a privilege not available to the radiologist. This is a privilege available only to the arthroscopic surgeon. And you can correlate the images and learn to read the images. Radiologists always say, always correlate with the clinical findings. I would add, always correlate with the arthroscopy findings. Thank you very much.
And we'll take the questions after the Dr. Gulati's talk.
Okay.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Dr. Mitchell. Ligament injuries.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good evening, everybody. At the onset, I wish to thank Professor Mani, Dr. Deepak for giving me this opportunity to be here with you all. I'll be talking about the knee ligaments, the last talk of the session. Before we go on to the ligaments, few basic things when we are doing the MR for the knee. We have to take all the three planes. Look at all the three planes, sagittal, coronal, axial. We are in a very bad habit, especially when you're looking at the cruciates, looking only at the sagittal. You miss a lot of information. And the two sequences which should be obtained are the proton density and the FATSAT images. T1 weighted images are not really helpful when you are evaluating the knee and, in fact, most of the musculoskeletal system. So, coming on to the ligaments, we all know they can be grouped as the mainly are the central pivot, which have the cruciates. On the anteromedial side, we have the medial collateral. Posteromedial, we have the posterior oblique and oblique popliteal. Anterolateral, we have the iliotibial band, and the postolateral, we have the arcuate complex, which has number of structures in it. And then we have the other multiple small ligaments like transverse ligament, ligament of Risberg, and ligament of Humphrey. Talking first about the anterior cruciate ligament, for which I think the ligament ACL and the menisci, these are the two areas for which MR is asked maximum times. Anterior cruciate ligament, on the sagittal scan, you can see it extends from the posteromedial aspect of the lateral femoral condyle, and it extends up to the anterior intercondylar eminence. It should have straight taut fibers. And if you see, it will have two components. Anterior one is the dense one. And then we also have the some fanning type of component in. So we have the anteromedial and the posterolateral component. Now, this is the importance of looking at the coronal and the axial planes. For talking first about the coronal planes, moving from anterior to posterior. Here you can see there's a broad footprint of the anterior cruciate ligament here, like a fan. But as you move up, you can see it becomes more dense. And the attachment at the level of the femoral condyle, it is much denser. So it has a smaller footprint at the femoral end and a broader footprint at the tibial end. Similarly, the axial scans are very, very important when you have to differentiate between the anteromedial and posterolateral. So this is the axial scan at the level of the femoral condyle, and you can see the anteromedial component, you can see the posterolateral. And here at the level of the tibial insertion, this is the medial component, and that's the lateral component, that's the larger medial meniscus. So it's easy to make out this is the medial side, this is the lateral side. And then you take thin scans and you can trace the entire cruciate ligament right from the femoral to the tibial end. So it's very important that you evaluate the anterior cruciate in all the three planes and don't just look at simply the sagittal scan. When we are looking at the ACL, we have to look at the ACL itself. Then the bone marrow edema pattern, because that itself can give you a lot of good information. And then any signs of impaction. Now, the direct signs of the ACL injuries are very simple. There can be disruption of the fibers, and this disruption can be either the femoral end, mid-substance, or the tibial end, depending upon the side. Or it can just give you a cloud-like type of amorphous mass type of appearance. And if you look at the signal intensity, in acute cases, you will see bright signal intensity on steroid or fat sat images, and iso-to-low intense on T1-weighted images. Now, then there are a number of indirect signs. In fact, nowadays, we don't really need these indirect signs, but earlier, we were a lot dependent upon indirect signs when we never used to get very, very thin scans when we started with the MR. But these indirect signs can definitely raise your antennas and can tell you that you have to look for an ACL tear. And these ACL tear indirect signs can be in the form of bone bruises or marrow edema. And the common ones in the ACL tears are along the anterior portion of the lateral femoral condyle and the posterolateral portion of the lateral tibial plateau. So if you see the bone contusion, because these can be seen very easily, they are looking bright on the fat sat images. So always look very carefully for the ACL tear. And associated with that, you can also see a deep lateral sulcus sign here. The lateral sulcus sign, the lateral sulcus is a portion of the lateral tibial plateau, which is close to the anterior horn of the lateral meniscus. Then other signs can be in the form of sigmoid fracture. Always look for thin sigmoid fracture because they're very small. At times on MR, the bony component may not be well seen, but these will be very well seen on the plain X-rays. So always send the plain X-rays to the radiologist when you are asking for MR. That can help you, that can help the radiologist in making a better diagnosis. Then other indirect signs can be in the form of the anterior translation of tibia in relation to the femoral condyle. Anything more than 5 millimeter is of clinical significance, and also associated with that, naturally, there'll be some uncovering of the lateral meniscus. So all these indirect signs, they give you a suggestion that there is an ACL tear. And of course, there'll be buckling of the posterior cruciate ligament. Normally, the posterior cruciate ligament is an arcuate-shaped structure. When there's an ACL tear, you will see the buckling. Another indirect sign can be in the with the straightening of the fibular collateral ligament. Normally, fibular collateral ligament on MR, you would not see in a single coronal plane. If a single coronal plane is showing you the complete fibular collateral ligament or lateral collateral ligament, that again gives an indirect indication that probably there is an ACL tear. So these are all indirect signs. So when we have the ACL injuries, we have to look at the site, whether it is primarily affecting the femoral end, proximal end, mid-substance, or the tibial. Then there are various ways to grade the injury. They can be grade one, like sprain. It can be partial thickness. And nowadays, it is very important to look for the single bundle injuries, because the repairs for single bundle injuries are also being done in RCT itself. And then we can have full thickness substance injury. That's one example of the sprain of the ACL. You can see the entire ACL is bulky. It's showing heterogeneous type of signal, but the integrity is maintained. And that's an example of partial thickness tear. You can see break in few of the fibers, but overall integrity is maintained. And then we can have full thickness tear, very easy to make out. There's no problem with that. That's another example of the full thickness ACL tear. And in this, you can see part of the fragment of the ACL lying close to the femoral end, and part of it is lying close to the tibial end. Always look for associated injuries to the other structures. You can see the tear in the medial meniscus, and there are also sprains of the lateral collateral ligament. There is a sprain of the medial collateral ligament. So the complete evaluation has to be done in all the three planes. And then the other variety of the ACL tear can be avulsion type of the ACL injury, where there is an avulsion at the insertion of the tibia. And in these cases, it is very essential to mention about the size of the bony fragment and the extent of the bony displacement. Then very important is to look out for single bundle injuries, because these are the ones which get messed up if you are not looking at all the three planes. And for this, I feel the axial planes are more important. Axial along with coronal are more important rather than the sagittal planes. This is one example where you can see there's a gap here. You can see the fluid here. That's a single bundle break in the enteromedial component. While this is in this patient, you can see the tibial attachment is perfectly normal while you are seeing a fluid here. So that's the single bundle, the posterolateral bundle involvement. And both these cases were proven arthroscopically, and they were repaired as well. When there's a chronic ACL injury, then the signs may be very indirect, signs may be subtle, especially because at times the ACL, especially if it was partially injured, it can get remodeled completely. So it's very important to have history and to compare with the earlier scans. The signs can be in the form of sulcus terminalis depression, which persists. Then there can be remodeling of the anterior cruciate ligament, or there's a complete absence here. Like this case, which had the partial thickness tear. This was the scan done in 2017. And just look, after 2 years, if we do not have the history, probably someone just label it as a normal ACL. So comparing with the earlier scan, whenever it's a chronic history, is very, very essential. Then we have to differentiate the tears from ganglion or the mucoid degeneration. Now the ganglions, these are basically cystic structures which are outlined by the pseudocapsule. And how to differentiate from tear is, if you see inside, you will see the integrity of the fibers is maintained. The ganglion will show you hyperintense signal on FATSAT as well as on the PD images. And that's a mucoid degeneration. In mucoid degeneration, again, it should not be mistaken for a tear, because if you try to trace the fibers, you can see complete integrity of all these individual fibers is maintained. So that's the way to differentiate a tear from a mucoid degeneration. Moving on to the next important ligament, that's the posterior cruciate ligament. It extends from the lateral aspect of the medial femoral condyle, and it goes to the posterior intercondylar eminence. Now, this also has two bundles, the anterolateral and posteromedial, but most of the times on MR, we really cannot differentiate between the two on the routine scans. And this has much more dense, homogeneous, low-intense signal than we had in the ACL, where it had the dense component and the lesser dense component. Now, this is the sequential sagittal scan, where you can see the complete normal integrity of the posterior cruciate ligament. That's in the coronal scan. Again, from the intercondylar eminence, you trace it, it runs obliquely and it gets attached to the medial femoral condyle. That's the fat sat images, and these are the proton density images, again showing you complete integrity of the posterior cruciate ligament very clearly. And that's in the axial scan, you're seeing the attachment at the condylar eminence, moving upwards, and then you can see the attachment at the medial femoral condyle. The PCL injuries, depending upon the extent, they can be grade 1. That's an example of grade 1, where you can see the integrity is fully maintained. Both these are grade 1. Integrity is fully maintained. Shape is also fully maintained, but it appears bulky, and it shows heterogeneous texture and heterogeneous signal intensity within, but there's no break in the integrity of the ligament. And that's a partial thickness. You can see partial thickness of the mid-substance and associated contusion or sprain of the rest of the posterior cruciate ligament. Then we can have a complete tear, or it can also have a, like we had in the ACL, there can be avulsion fracture of the posterior cruciate ligament. It may not always be possible to really see the bony fragment, as we cannot really appreciate here, but at times you can see it. And there you can take the help of the CT or the plain X-rays, and the information required again will be how much is the displacement and what is the size of the bony fragment. Now, this is the type of appearance you should not mistake again for the tear. This is basically the mucoid degeneration of the posterior cruciate ligament. Now, if you look at the axial scan, you can clearly make out that it is basically a mucoid degeneration and not the interstitial or any tear of the posterior cruciate ligament. So it's very essential to evaluate these ligaments at least in two planes, if not all three. Now, when we are talking about PCL, then we also talk about the meniscofemoral ligament. Meniscofemoral ligament extends from the lateral meniscus, goes to the medial femoral condyle. At the level of the posterior cruciate ligaments, it splits into two components. The anterior one is ligament of Humphrey, that's the ligament of Humphrey, and then posterior one is the ligament of Riesberg. At times there can be break here, and that we call as the Riesberg tear. Moving on to the lateral complex, or what we call as the arcuate complex, which has lateral collateral ligament, arcuate ligament, phallofibular ligament, popliteofibular ligament, popliteomeniscal fascicles. Let's see them one by one. The main one is the lateral collateral ligament or the fibular collateral ligament. Now, fibular collateral ligament, it takes an oblique course. It starts at the lateral femoral condyle, goes down, and it gets inserted into the fibular head. And in most of the cases, it will also get attachment with the biceps femoris, and it forms a conjoint tendon and it gets attached to the fibular head. So this is a very important section, especially when you are evaluating the posterolateral corner of the knee. You are seeing the biceps femoris, you are seeing the lateral collateral ligament, you are also seeing the popliteus tendon. So this is very essential for evaluation of the posterolateral corner of the knee, and you have to evaluate them very carefully. And if you look at the axial scan, you can beautifully see that's the lateral collateral ligament, that's the biceps femoris, and as we go down, they're getting united, forming a conjoint tendon and getting inserted into the on the fibular head. And that's the sagittal plane, again formation of the conjoint tendon by the two components. Now, like other injuries, the lateral collateral ligament injuries, they can also are usually divided into three. Grade 1, that's a feathery type of pattern. The integrity of the ligament is well maintained. There may be subtle intra-substance hyperintensity, but there will be edema around it, or there will be a small amount of fluid around the intact ligaments. That's grade 1 or sprain. And then we have grade 2, in which there is break in few of the fibers, in addition to the fluid or hyperintensity seen on the two sides of the ligament. Or it can be a complete tear, which is very easy to diagnose. There's no problem in diagnosing complete tears. And that's another example of a high-grade tear. But this is an example where you can see the biceps femoris is intact, but there's avulsion of the lateral collateral ligament at the side. And that's another example of the avulsion injury. But in this case, there's complete avulsion. The biceps as well as the lateral collateral ligament both have got avulsed. Then we have with the tiny ones, these are the synovial ligamentous complexes, the popliteal meniscal ligaments or the fascicles, which attach the dental meniscus to the popliteus tendon. Arcuate ligament on MR, not seen in all the cases. It's a, some people feel that it is only a part of the capsule. No, this is basically a Y-shaped structure, gets attaches to the fibular head, goes upwards, and it has one lateral limb, which is going, that's a medial limb, which is going to the capsule, and the lateral limb, which gets attached to lateral femoral condyle. Now, this gets attached to a fibular head. So whenever there's an injury or there's an avulsion, it's called as the arcuate sign, in which there's an avulsion from the fibular head at the site of insertion of the arcuate ligament. Fibular ligament is seen practically in those cases where we have the large fibula. And this is very important to pick up these ligaments because they get messed up. And at times, if they are not, if their tears are not picked up, they can lead to persistent pain. And this is the this is the fibula seen on MR, and that's the fibrofibular ligament. While if you look at this patient, you can see that's the fibula here, and there's a complete break in the fibrofibular ligament at this side. Then popliteofibular ligament. Again, few people feel that this is basically a part of the popliteus itself. This again is a Y-shaped type of structure from the popliteus. As it tries to become intra-articular, it sends few fibers to the fibular head. And so that's the popliteofibular ligament. That's in the sagittal scan, fibulofibular ligament. There are a lot of anatomical variations, especially in the lateral ligaments. Lateral collateral ligaments, popliteus tendon, they are seen practically 100% patients on MR. While if you look at the other things, popliteomeniscal fascicles, popliteofibular, arcuate, or fibulofibular, their pickup rate on in various studies on MR is very variable. Some people report even 8 to 10% only few of the ligaments. The last important ligament is the medial collateral ligament, which extends from the medial femoral epicondyle, and it goes downwards and gets inserted into tibia, distal to the tibial plateau. This has two components, the superficial and the deep. And primarily what most of the times what we are evaluating and what we are commenting on MR, it's basically the superficial component. Like LCL injuries, the MCL injuries also are grade 1. When there is a mild tear or only a sprain, you will see the integrity is perfectly normal, but there is a hyperintense signal on these FAT-SAT images around this intact ligament. That's the grade 1. That's another example of grade 1 where you can see the normal integrity of the ligament, but there's a fluid or edema around on either side of the ligament. Or we can have grade 2 in which there's a partial disruption. The outer fibers, they are intact, but you can see there's a break in some of the fibers. So that's grade 2. Or it can be a frank grade 3, like we have, there's a disruption which can be at either end or in between. Another example of the grade 3 tear. Very rarely, there can be avulsion injury also of the medial collateral ligament. Like this is one example of the avulsion injury of the medial collateral.
What about the last 3 minutes, sir?
Yeah, only 2 slides left.
Yeah, thanks.
So in chronic patients, there can be ossification at the site of attachment of the medial collateral ligament. That's what we call as a Pellegrini-Stata syndrome. And on MR, on all the sequences, whether it is T1, PD, or the FAT-SAT, you will see low intense signal. That signifies the ossified portion. This again, I don't know about the orthopedician, but in radiology, these two ligaments again are of controversy because most of the people, most of them feel that this is only a part of the joint capsule. And posterior oblique ligament is considered to be part of the posterior portion of the medial collateral ligament, while oblique popliteal ligament, that is considered is basically a slip from the posterior oblique ligament as well as from the semitendinosus. Then this is the last ligament I'm going to talk. That's a transverse ligament. On 3 Tesla systems, we have started picking up, or we can see this transverse ligament in most of the cases. And this is basically easy to pick up, especially on the axial scans. You can see the band connecting the two menisci.
The importance is that in the sagittal scan, if you are not looking at the axial scan, you can mistake it as a tear of the anterior horn of the meniscus. And in that case, either look at the axial scan or you look at your sagittal scans very carefully and you will see this is not a tear, but you can see that's a ligament which is going through and through in the center. So that's a transverse ligament. And transverse ligament tears also have been labeled as a cause of the anterior knee pain. So to summarize, when you are looking at the ligaments for the evaluation of the knee ligaments, very important to look at all the three planes, especially for ACL. Look at axial, coronal, sagittal. The two images important are the fat sat and PD. T1 may not be of great help. Bony contusions can give you an indirect evidence of various injuries. And we must keep in mind that isolated injuries are uncommon. If you see one, look for more. Like, for example, in this case, although this has only a grade 2 ACL injury, but there is a grade 1 injury to the PCL also. There is a lateral, there's a medial collateral ligament sprain also, and there's a lateral collateral ligament sprain also. So always see menisci, ligaments, and surrounding structure in totality. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Gulati, sir. I think the knee session was covered completely in all aspects of meniscus and ligaments. The session is open for discussion. Any question from the faculty? There's a question from Dr. Ravi Chauhan. He said, in cases of ACL and PCL avulsion, which we usually diagnose on preliminary X-ray, when we advise for MRI? In angry knee, or should we wait for some time? Dr. Gulati.
I think for the complete evaluation of the extent of avulsion and to see the what is happening to the rest of the ligament, we should get the MR done, because MR is one modality which will not only tell you how much is the extent of the avulsion of the bony fragment as well the status of the rest of the meniscus. So it should be done.
There's one question for Dr. Mittal. Any yes. tips to see for discoid meniscus in children?
Okay, if you do just a plain X-ray, you will see that the lateral joint space is more than the medial joint space in absence of any ligament injury. So that's one indicator on plain X-ray if you have an increased joint space on the lateral side. And if you do a MR, you can see not a triangle, but a slab-like configuration in more than three consecutive sections. That's an indicative of a discoid meniscus. Also, you can trace the meniscus up till the notch of the femoral condyle. So that indicates again that this is a much bigger and a discoid meniscus. Probably Dr. Praveen can add to what I said.
I think you have given the correct answer. If you look at the sequentially scans, if you are seeing the meniscus in more than three sections, that is one indication. And I will just add one thing. If you take an axial scan, because what I feel, axial scans in the knee are underutilized. If there is a coverage in the axial scan, if you can see the coverage of the meniscus, how much it is covering, you can give a definite diagnosis that, okay, we are dealing with a discoid meniscus. So in addition to what you said, I feel the axial scan should also be taken into consideration.
Dr. Mitra, I want to add one question for you. When you indicate for surgery for discoid meniscus, what is the main reason for MR finding, or you find any specific symptoms on the patient when you plan for surgery for discoid meniscus?
See, discoid meniscus is a normal congenital variant. People come with two complaints usually. Either they have a thud sound on flexion and extension, or they come with knee pain. Now, if they come with the thud sound, I don't operate them, because this is a God-given meniscus and it just makes a sound, it doesn't give pain. Don't operate on these patients. Let them continue as such. When they come with pain, that indicates a meniscus tear. And that is when you operate. And often, now this collagen is not a normal collagen arrangement in the meniscus as the usual one. So even the type 2 tears, that means you see a white line in the background of black, which is not touching the superior or the inferior articular surface, even these meniscus are symptomatic and they are painful. So this is an exception where you operate for grade 2 or meniscal lesion because that's an intrasubstance tear, and then you have to saucerize it. So you look for meniscus tear either grade 3 or grade 2, and then you operate only when they're painful. If they're not painful, don't operate.
So the message is, if it is a normal discoid meniscus, don't operate.
Don't operate. Either it, God has given a thicker shock absorber, let it be.
Yeah.
Can I ask one thing, Dr. Yes. Mittal? Yes. These discoid yes. menisci, they are very prone to tears. Yes. Do you ever advocate sort of preventive type of surgery?
Sir, if the tear is not there, then what are you going to repair? So, if the patient is asymptomatic, it is very difficult to convince a patient for surgery. And secondly, if you go inside, what are you going to repair? It is only when it becomes painful, you have a tear, then you do a surgery.
Okay.
As of now, I don't know about any
preventive surgery. No, what I want to know is, like, can you do some partial meniscectomy or something so that the size becomes practically normal?
Sir, as far as I know, that is not recommended. Patient has no pain, so why operate?
Okay.
Dr. Mitra, I want to ask one question to you. You explained so well the root lesion, root tears, and the ramp lesions. If it's a Viva question, you can't explain on the pictures. How you say what is root lesion and what is ramp lesion? It's a Viva question. You can't just
Viva for me. No, I have to prepare for it.
Yeah.
Okay, fine. Okay. See, root is very different from the ramp lesion. Let me say first. If we understand then this, that root of a meniscus is very different from the ramp area. Ramp area you cannot see from anterior portal. You have to go in the posterior compartment to see the ramp lesion. And that is a meniscocapsular lesion of the posterior horn of medial meniscus in presence of ACL. That is a ramp lesion. And that's a vertical longitudinal tear. Whereas a root tear, you can see from the anterior portal, and it is a tear where the meniscus root attaches on tibia.
Right.
Okay. I wish I could show you some arthroscopy pictures, but this is not the time of video to show you. It's very different.
Right, sir.
The ramp doesn't extend to the root. It is posterior. Vertical longitudinal meniscocapsular lesion. Whereas the root is a radial tear where it is attaching on the tibia.
Right.
The root.
Thank you, sir. Any more question from the faculty?
Dr. Ravi, I was listening to your point that a ramp should be diagnosed only in the presence of an ACL tear. So what would you call a meniscocapsular separation which happens in a patient who does not have an ACL tear? Even if the tear is at the same place and the patient does not have an ACL tear, you wouldn't call that an ramp lesion?
Yes. So, first of all, the patients who have meniscocapsular area in absence of ACL tear, they are usually in the body. They are not in the posterior horn. So if you have a posterior horn tear in presence of ACL, that's the definition of ramp lesion. If you don't have an ACL tear and you still have a peripheral tear of the meniscus, that will be a vertical longitudinal tear but not be classified as a ramp lesion. That is as per the classification.
Right.
I think we have covered all the areas today, and no more questions from chat box, no more question from faculty. Then I hand over to Dr. Manning. Thank you all the faculty, and thank you for your time for today evening. And I hope we have learned some new things from everyone. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Dr. Bageja, for conducting an excellent musculoskeletal imaging, CME. This has been a very, very important event for DOA for the last 10 years. And I think Hitesh is there. Hitesh,
Thank you all faculty, the shoulder faculty, Dr. Sriram, Dr. Shekhar, the spine faculty, Dr. Guru Raj and Dr. Bhaksi, Dr. Ritu Verma, Dr. Ravi Mittal and Praveen Gulati. As said by our president, this CME, musculoskeletal imaging, is a traditional affair. As we know, the clinical radiologic correlation is very good for, very important for surgical results. So this has been traditionally moderated by a vice president, Dr. Bageja, in our case. And thank you, Dr. Bageja, for moderating this session. And with this CME on MSK imaging is also part of our bone and joint week. And with this, we kickstart the bone and joint week. And the motto given by our president, Indian Orthopedic Association, this year is save self, save one. And I think we planned this week very well, and we are going metaphysical this year, as we feel that mental health is also important, more important than bone health. So we are metaphysical this year. We'll be having on 3rd August a talk on work-life balance by Sister Divine Sister Shivani of Brahma Kumari fame. And do join us at 7 p.m. That will be a webinar. On 4th August, we have three talks, and they are beyond professional life. And one is by Dr. Mohit, which is a very good talk, 8 transformations that will change your life. And one is by Dr. Harpal, that is hard work pays, and other is by on financial health. On 7th, we culminate this week with a musical evening. And do join us on in PSY and on e-platform for this musical evening, hosted by Dr. Yash Gulati. And besides this, we are doing a plantation drive. We had a morning walkathon and cyclothon at Nehru Park today also. And we will be doing school education on this topic. And we have prepared a video, which was video prepared by Ms. Sharma. Plantation drive will be by Dr. Vijay Jain. And we will be educating school children in basic life support, and that will be the part of our board and joint week this year. Thank you
then. Thanks all, and have a nice evening and a weekend. We've got one medal through PV Sindhu. Hockey team has reached the semi-finals after 41 years, so enjoy yourself. Bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you, Dr. Gulati. Thank you, Dr. Mittal,
thank
sir.
You. Thank you,
sir.
Yes, yeah, she